Yo.
Oh, dance party.
Oh, shoot.
In it. Live. Freaking A.
Hello.
What up, what up?
We're here. We're doing it, guys.
I just read a comment that said, over, under, Aaron and Daniel getting into it. Oh, can you imagine?
What's
going to be real cool. Hey, this is going to be a good time. Hi. How is everyone?
Hello. Good. How are you, Chers?
Oh, great. I was actually talking to a friend today about how I haven't listened to this record in a really long time. So a lot of this stuff's going to be coming back new to me. I'm very pumped.
Yeah, so we're going to have a couple people. Obviously, Daniel's going to be on. He's going to call in soon. And Matt Goldman, who worked on the record. And I was talking to Matt Goldman, you know, working this thing out the other day. And he was like, typical Matt Goldman. So should I listen? I haven't listened to the record forever. Should I jog my memory and so I can get some stories, or should I just wait and get it on the spot? And I was like, you know, whatever you want to do, man. He's like very indecisive about it. So see what he says.
Yeah, maybe it. You know, maybe we'll listen to it for a bit. We'll pause for a second. Go get some food. Go get some eats, and then come back and really hit it hard.
We'll get some sounds. The first song, ran down the freaking daily eats.
Dude, I can't wait to see Matt Goldman.
You should ask him if he knows like the EQ settings and stuff, like, you know, on the preamps and everything. Let him know it's really important to the people watching, you know, that he divulges his secrets and see if he remembers anything.
What if Goldman has like president's face, or we see him and he looks 90 now? And we haven't seen him in like 5 years.
If he doesn't have the same facial hair, I'm going to be super bummed and just feel awkward.
I think the last time we saw Matt was in Atlanta at the Tab, right?
It was for me, for sure.
Yeah. Hey, Spee, are you muted? Spee is muted. We can't hear Spee. Why is that? Oh, Grant doesn't want to hear from Spencer, I think. What? I think that's the problem.
What?
Oh, Twitch noob over here. Spee, are you sure you're not muted on your end?
So, Grant, you can mute any of us you want to?
Oh, that's God power, son.
Hate.
I heard first episode we were getting muted left and right.
You should be good. Let me hear your voice there. That beautiful voice.
There he is. Let's hear those paws clacking on the floor.
I hit unmute okay? It's thanks one button supposed to cover band, all of them.
Thanks for having me back, Grant.
Hey, welcome somebody back says, to the band.
Somebody says Chris is using his big boy mic this week. That's because I
new
don't
cable.
No, it turns out I had a synth plugged into my mixer that I didn't know, and it was off. So it was just sending a horrible buzz because it was turned off. And now I'm learning how to use cables and microphones finally after like 20 years of doing this. So,
It's not here I am. Your job or anything.
Yeah, it's not like it's what I do for a living or anything, but.
I was outside today pushing Max, thinking about tonight. Trying to think about when we made this record, and it was 10 years ago. Think about that. 10 years ago.
That's wild. That's crazy. Yeah. I had one of those, you know, those memory things that will show up in your phone from your photos where the iPhone makes like a video. One of them was, it was all James pictures. It says, hey, there's this memory of James. I was like, yeah, I'll pop that up. And one of the main things that I had on there was the video of James from in the studio doing this record when he was doing his Axl Rose, like whatever that thing is. I'll pull it up later and show everybody. It's one of my favorites. It made me so happy.
Awesome. Yeah, I just remember that. Glad I could still entertain you.
James has already said more than all of last week combined. LOL. Love to see it.
No, I started strong last week and had about three sentences. So I might double down this week.
The next sentence is just going to taper off. It's not even going to finish.
And, well, you guys have a good check. See ya.
And I'm out. I guess we should probably address the Underoath news today, too, as well, to everyone that's here.
It's news to us, too, today, somewhat.
Yeah, well...
Well,
one day late for us, but yeah. If you haven't heard, unfortunately, KnotFest has been canceled. Which sucks. Super bum, but it was expected, but still.
Yeah, I was crossing my fingers for a postponement. But Sinead. then we got the word last night that it's a straight up we're not doing this thing. So I think we have a group text with our it's like band and our crew as well. And our guitar player Diego, he made a good point. He was like, dude, this lineup is too good to not do again at some point. Like I would hope that when all this stuff is through that Slipknot's like, yo, that thing we were gonna do, we should finally do that thing, because yeah, that'd be sick.
Yeah. Sure. So no touring.
Now we're going to have so much more free time to hang out and look at each other on computers.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do it.
This is life now. This is it.
Grant, you're now the leader. This is your band now. Good luck.
All right.
I'll just be over here in the corner. God bless.
I'm never leaving my house again.
This is the I'm the front man now. This is we're performing this way. This is the scenario.
My wife is 35 weeks pregnant, and she came downstairs to my studio setup here today, and she goes, "Do you think it'd be safe if I went to Target?" And I realized that she goes, "I haven't left my house since February 29th. She
doesn't go anywhere.
Really?
No, she doesn't go anywhere because she's been pregnant, right? So she's like, she was super nervous at first. And I go, honey, let's, you know, put a mask on. I'll take your ass to Target tomorrow. She's just like, I need to leave.
Dude, my oldest daughter, Madeline, today, she kind of had today was her breaking point. She was like, this is never going to end. I'm just like, it will. I promise. But
son, who's 8, Joel, is literally, he loves it. He thinks it rules. Like, he literally goes, school's only an hour and a half long. Like, then he just does what he wants, goes outside, rides his bike around the neighborhood, just ripping, dude. He has a later bedtime because the school doesn't start till later, like the, you know, the virtual school. So he just is ripping. He told me the other day he hopes it never ends.
Oh, man.
Just ripping. Ripping.
So I think one good thing to jump in on this record, and it seems like most of the comments are already pointing that out, but obviously, Aaron, you know, you weren't on this record.
Do you know that, Aaron?
You.
So that's the,
I was there.
I'd like to hear your favorite part of making this record. But all jokes aside, where were you? So to give everyone context, this is, as James said, like, you know, 10 years ago, 2009, 2010, all that, what were you doing while we were doing this? And obviously our paths crossed socially and things like that, but you were in Paramore, correct?
I was in Paramore soon after that. I left Underoath for no real reason in 2009, I guess. No, I became, all joking aside, I became like, I have an anxiety thing that I deal with that I've dealt with my whole life, but I became like, I really internalized it and became crazy and quit the band and became hyper religious and tried to play worship music. So I think when you guys finished making this record, I was finishing up a worship album, and then joined Paramore not long after that. But I feel like the first time I heard Disambiguation was in Brandon Ebel's studio where Aaron was in Seattle, because I was living in Seattle for the summer making my first worship record, which I thought was what I was supposed to do. And I guess now that I look back on it, it all seems really frivolous and silly. And if I was who I am now, I wouldn't have walked away. I still like draw so many questions about that time, about myself as a man. But I was in Seattle the first time I heard this record. And I feel like maybe Ebel even showed it to me or something. I don't remember. And Spencer called me. My biggest memory of Disambiguation is Spencer called me when I was in the studio making this worship record. And he said, why did you do that to me? he goes, that was the most difficult thing I've ever done. Why did you leave me to do that on my own? So that's my memory when I think about Disambiguation, you know. And then obviously I didn't really get into it until we started the band again. And after Rebirth, we started playing some Disamb songs, which are a ton of fun to play. So, yeah.
I think trying to go back and remember that, because that was obviously a long time ago, I think even with all the issues you had going on as well, Aaron, I think that you were just kind of at that point moving musically in a different direction at the time, or wanted to go in a different direction for a while.
There was a musical aspect too.
Yeah.
But it was socially so much of a larger aspect that sometimes I don't remember. You know, Disambiguation, obviously, for anyone here knows, it's really, 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 really heavy. And Daniel slayed that for sure. But we had kind of started to write some of it. And I just don't know that I completely sunk into the material. And the funny thing is now, like, I'm just game for whatever. But I was just so hard-headed back then. And I think that I thought that I brought a lot to the table. And I'm not saying that I don't, but I thought that I wasn't heard. And to me, that's such a small piece of it, because emotionally and socially, I was so in turmoil that I guess that's why I often don't remember the musical portion to me leaving Underoath. You know, more often than not, I remember the social, emotional.
Yeah.
Aspect. I think it started becoming, getting a little alienated at around like 2008 and 2009. I think when you were like kind of like not finishing certain tours, you know, at times, like that. Sure. That was like really hard on everyone, I think.
I don't excuse sort of the erratic nature that I had then. I just don't understand it. Like, I don't know where I was coming from. And I guess, you know, for me, I had to get like professional and medical help. So I guess maybe that's why it's hard for me sometimes when asked about this, you know, to go back into it, understand it, because it's so hard to understand for me, because it just seems so irrational for who I am now, you know, and who I actually am. It's like I stepped outside for a few years and was like a lot of people do, whether it's drug use or whether it's, you know, you get out on the fringes of yourself and you're like, what the hell am I doing? So I look back on it now and see it that way. But at the time, I thought I had made the correct left turn, if you will. So, yeah.
Somebody in the chat actually just asked what songs on the album were already in progress with Aaron before he left. And I can't remember the answer to that.
I can't remember if there was any either.
I'm sure we were working on stuff.
There was a couple, because we moved. I was trying to remember this earlier today when I was watering the grass. We moved from one spot in Falkenberg to another one. Remember? We
got that little office area.
The little office area that had air conditioner. And
yep.
Aaron Sprinkle came and listened to some stuff. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Like, he came and listened to some stuff that we were making. And I know it was some of these. I know it was some of these songs, because I've listened to this record once or twice. I have a vinyl copy, and I got drunk one night and put it on. I was really interested. This is semi recently, like probably 2017. It was right before we made Erase Me, and I remember hearing stuff that I was like, oh, I remember that. But I don't even know the song names other than the ones that I've learned to play live. So I don't know.
Yeah, I don't remember.
So Sprinkle came to Florida?
You were there, bud. Yeah, yeah.
I don't think so.
Yeah, you 100%. I remember him. I vividly remember him like setting up microphones. We recorded. This is when Tim first started kind of messing with recording.
In Falkenberg, we did this.
Yeah, in the new Falkenberg.
Yeah,
the little office area. And I remember Tim brought his computer and we were recording. Like, it was like a really guerrilla, like, Tim was recording like just room sounds. And I remember Sprinkle setting up microphones. It was weird. That's a really weird memory.
I do remember there was like that you did the Almost record and you were like, Sprinkle will crush the next record. And it was like, Sprinkle, like he's done so many different things. And, you know, I remember that just being like, why would he fit? It's like, you just got to see it. And I remember obviously Brandon being excited about it. I didn't even remember that until you mentioned that. But I remember that was like a similar to like the Feldman thing. Like, we'll give it a shot. Like, we'll have him come down and see where we go. And I remember it being, yeah, almost not forgettable in the sense that it wasn't valuable. It was more just like what didn't seem to resonate like naturally with anybody.
Yeah. Back to what Grant was asking about, like my musical kind of the way I felt musically alienated at the time, is I think that the Sprinkle thing was like, for me, it was like some like weird last ditch effort. And I wasn't thinking about leaving at that point, but it was like some weird last ditch thing for me to kind of get my foot in the door creatively. You know what I mean? And not that I wasn't allowed to have my foot in the door, but I think in my 27-year-old brain, like if Sprinkle does this, then maybe like it'll be like 25-year-old brain. It'll be, I can like kind of weasel my way to make things more melodic or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, I think that for me, that could have been the thing. I'm not sure. So
no, I agree with that. I remember, I mean, not going into it briefly, but I remember even just recording Lost was like that was like the beginning, I think, of a struggle of like you wanting to put a lot of melodic parts over parts that we were like, no, let's keep this arty or heavy or whatever you want to call it, and cutting a lot of parts. And I think that was kind of the initial starting of the separation of like the direction you were going musically to where we were at the time. Obviously.
Yeah, and I think in hindsight for a lot of that, it was, I think that Aaron was probably pushing for things that didn't make as much sense to me musically, but in hindsight, like some of the stuff I, in particular small parts of songs on Lost, you know, I hear and I remember the thing that Aaron wanted to do, and I'm like, oh man, that would have, you know, that would have been cool. And I think that both parties, like, because it was a lot of it was a, I think, you know, it was an Aaron versus everybody thing in a lot of ways. And I think that everybody was trying to overcompensate. Like, I think that in a way it was like, well, we want it to be like extra heavy. And you're like, well, I want it to be extra melodic. Where if I wonder if there would have actually been able to be like, you know, mid 30s us having conversations. Ground, yeah.
So to speak. Yeah.
I also don't think that the record was heading in this direction pre-Daniel.
No.
Because I remember Daniel showing up, and I remember just being like, whoa, this shit is getting wildly weird and heavy. Like, I remember that distinctly. Like, it wasn't, like, heading in that direction before.
Yeah, I remember that in particular. Like, but for me, that was like, I was like, yes, like, it's getting crazy now. Like, and I loved that vibe that Daniel brought to it. Like at the time, that was like exactly what I was looking for. I don't know, it's weird to look back on that stuff in hindsight and see, you know, and actually like think about why you were feeling the way that you were feeling. I don't know, it's weird.
I can't like, you know, now if you guys were to come to me tomorrow and go, oh, this album is, say the album we're, you know, we're thinking about right now, like whatever's next after Erase Me, and you guys were like, we want to make the heaviest shit ever, I'd be like, okay, like, it wouldn't matter to me. I don't know why it mattered then. Mm-hmm. I can't figure it out. You know what I mean?
A lot of things mattered when we were younger. I think that we don't really care about anymore.
I think when you're 25, like I see for me now, I think at 36 years old, almost 37 years old, I can look at it and go, well, maybe the next record will be different. You know, I don't look at it like this is the end, but back, you know, when you're that age,
it's,
and you're
your
in,
life, it's everything.
It's everything. Yeah. And not that I don't care about Underoath, because I obviously deeply, deeply, deeply do. But I just, if Tim called me on the phone tomorrow and Spencer called me on the phone tomorrow, they're like, we're going to make a record that's all screaming. I would go, okay, sounds fun. I'll play the craziest shit you can figure out on the drums. It wouldn't be a thing. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know why it's a thing, why it was a thing then, but it was.
Yeah.
I think it's part of growing up. It's like, I always think about that Deftones or the Nine Inch Nails thing. Like when one record's rock and the one next record is electronic and weird, there's one that's instrumental. I'm like, it doesn't make them who they are. They just like, it's just different every time, just whatever they're feeling. Like I could see us making a crazy heavy record again one day, or making a whatever else we could think of. And I don't think we would care or be upset the way we were when we were younger.
I think the best art is the art you want to make at the time. And that's why every Underoath record has its space, in my opinion, even the one that I have nothing to do with, because to me,
the good one,
the one that mattered.
Yeah.
The one that really did it, you know, the one that pushed it over the edge. No, but for real, like, I feel like art is whatever you make at the time. And I think that's important.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There's a few songs on the record, like Paper Lung, that I think are really strong points for Underoath. And then the two you guys released last, Sunburnt and what's the other one?
I love those two songs.
Two songs are super special. And I'm glad that they exist. And I think that art's whatever you make now, you know? And I just, for some reason, we spent 20 minutes talking about it, but I don't know. I don't have an answer, but yeah.
Grant, what time is Daniel hopping in?
So yeah, I was going to just get to that in a second. Before we're going to get him and actually Goldman in here in a second. Just jump them both in. Before we jump into that, just want to give everyone a chat. What's up? Thanks for coming. Thanks for hanging. Just a little bit more.
I'm keeping an eye on that whole thing.
Yeah, a little more info. Just we're trying to make this as smooth as possible. Obviously, I'm not trying to talk over people. I was doing that a little bit last time. If you have questions, what we're going to try and do is when we listen to the tracks, if you have questions about the song or maybe to anyone, we're going to be checking the chat during the songs and answering some questions after each song. So keep that in mind. And other than that, we are now home for ever, I don't know. So we're just trying to make this as cool as possible at the same time, like trying to make this, like, you know, as good as we can make it. That being said, we are, if you can see on the top of the screen up here, doing a giveaway for subscribers. If you're interested, totally cool. If not, we should appreciate any support, but it will be some cool stuff that, you know, isn't the standard thing you can just go buy online. So if you want to subscribe, you have Twitch Prime, it's free. Subscribe, feel free to do it. That being said, let me see if I can get these dudes in here. I think they're actually watching, so let me just shoot them a text and you guys can keep chatting.
Creeps.
While I do this.
What do you have, Chris?
This is Coke Zero and some very lowbrow off-brand whiskey that my dad requested when he came for Christmas.
Chris, who are you?
What's it called?
It's called hold on, what's it called?
Old Granddad.
It's Kessler. So here's the thing. It comes in a bottle like this, because hold on. My dad was coming for Christmas. And I was like, hey, do you guys want anything to drink? Want anything to eat? He was like, oh, got to make sure you have Kessler whiskey. I was like, okay, ew. I don't know what that is, but I'll go find it. It comes in a bottle like this big, and it's a plastic bottle. And this is like my dad's jam. It was like $15 for like a gallon of it. And I bought it. It's still like this full. And I was like, oh, I'll make a little drink to hang out with my friends.
Horse piss.
You guys,
I made the joke that it's probably in a plastic bottle so that when you're drinking half of the bottle straight out of the bottle, when you drop it, it doesn't shatter. It's in a plastic bottle.
Yeah, Tim, James, did you get a chance to?
Grant, you're muted. Man. We can't hear you.
Oh my gosh, sorry.
Oh gosh.
Don't hate on Evan Williams.
I saw somebody. I'm sorry about him.
I saw somebody say Grant is now the president of Underoath.
Mike is so touchy. All right, here we go. Here we go.
I feel like something's about to happen. Isaac Goldman. Yeah, boy. Yeah.
Are you on your son's computer?
No, I'm on an iMac, though I may have to, speaking of my son, I might have to get off a little because.
Of course.
Hold on. There's a miscommunication.
We'll just get some sounds and then we'll take a break.
No, he has a test he has to take. I didn't know about. Ruth didn't understand the whole situation.
Oh, Ruth.
He has to take his test in this room, so we'll see how late he can. I don't know when he has to turn the test in tonight. So.
Okay.
I'm sure he'll be fine.
What class is it? How's he doing in it?
It's computer engineering. He aces everything, and we don't even.
Oh, he's fine. He could take one down.
Yeah, he's fine. He could probably not even turn it in. It's his final. He can turn it in. He still passes.
It'll be a learning experience, life experiences. Sometimes you can't win everything, you know?
Right. I'm trying to
get Goldman, great to see you.
Great to see you, Matt Goldman.
What the heck is new and exciting in your neck of the woods? I feel like I haven't seen you in 9,000 years.
You know, I'm not going to bore you with all the personal news, but I got some cool stuff going on. I'm really excited about. There's a nonprofit in Chattanooga that I'm going to be working with, doing basically teaching high school kids recording and photography and audio and videography and that sort of thing.
Oh, that's awesome.
So the goal is so they graduate high school and not waste your money on whatever recording school, because it's a waste of money. So that's awesome. It's a really exciting thing. We've already got a lot of momentum and we're about to build a studio and start some new classes, but with this whole mess, we can't really do anything. So we're just in a holding pattern. But anyway, I'm kind of stoked about that.
That's awesome. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah, it's going to be sweet.
So Tim was saying that he spoke to you and you were asking if you should, because you haven't listened to this album in forever, nor have a bunch of us. He said that you said, should I brush up on this thing a little bit or should I just go in blind? Which did you decide to do?
I had to listen to it. What I wanted to do, and I didn't have time, I just pulled in from Chattanooga just as this started, but I was hoping to get home in time to actually open the sessions up, because I listened to the record and there's stuff on the record like, crap, I don't remember that at all. And so I had to go back and look at it and see what we did, but I didn't get a chance yet to. So I'm going to do that tonight. When we're done, I'll go back and open up the sessions and see what it was that we did to do that stuff.
Send me
those
sessions.
Do you remember
that
sample that you put on the Chariot record 2 months after you made this record and me and Chris called you out on it?
God, no.
Oh, what?
Oh, that's we do.
Oh, yes. Daniel! What's up?
What sample was it?
Okay, hold on. I have to tell this. So the 68 came and recorded at your place.
Was it 68 or the Chariot at this point?
Oh, it was the 68.
It was 68.
Okay.
And Tim, who heard it first? Was it you?
I'm pretty sure it was one of us. And I just remember going, dude, Daniel, Josh, Daniel and Underoath, Goldman everywhere, something's fishy here.
Yeah, so I was listening to the 68 record. And about three quarters of the way through the record, there is a keyboard part that my keyboard part from Disambiguation. Like literally, it was literally just the track. And I texted Josh and I was like,
I do remember that now.
Yeah. And I was like, hey, did you guys just take my stem from Disambiguation and fly it over to your record? And he was like, oh yeah, you know, Matt said he figured it'd be cool. You're cool. So dude, you know, we figured it was fine.
I texted Matt. Me and you were listening to it, Chris. And I texted Matt. I'm like, dude, did you literally rip our patch for this 68 song? And he's like, no, me and Josh were talking about it. He said he really liked it. So I just opened up the session, just threw it in.
It wasn't the patch. It was the track.
Yeah, whole track.
Just flew it into the 68 record.
I remember that now.
That was great. I love that.
With Josh, there are no rules. And well, I mean, the goal is to break rules. Break as many rules as you can. And we haven't been sued yet. So
including the law.
Daniel,
you guys,
how are you,
dude? What song it was? Anyone know what song it was?
For the people, I'll find it and send it to you. I forget.
Okay. No, yo, just because
Daniel's here. I haven't seen your face in 2 years, dog. How are you?
I'm all right.
I'm great. Yeah. I haven't seen you guys in many, many years.
So and good to see you.
This is my first time ever doing one of these Twitch Zooms. Zoom Twitches.
Welcome to the world, bro.
Are you still in the Southwest?
Yeah, I'm living on a ranch just about an hour outside of Tucson.
Cool.
Classic.
Yeah, I'm sitting in my camper.
Classic
right
Davison.
Now.
Are you a rancher?
I'm a Jolly Rancher. I'm a ranch hand.
Wait, are you on your laptop? Did you get it working?
I'm on Tess's.
Okay.
Mine just died.
Yeah.
And thanks, Chris, for offering to give me some insight.
Yeah, sorry I couldn't help.
Yeah, IT. Pretty deep into the code.
The Matrix.
Oh, man.
So that laptop, my laptop that just died, I got on a day off when I was on tour with you guys and I flew to New York to see Portishead. And while I was there, I got a new computer and then barely made it back to the show the next day. I forget where it was, somewhere in the Midwest. But...
And that's the computer that died?
Yeah.
Dude. And got your money's worth.
That story is not weird or even interesting, but the most interesting part of it is the day I got that computer was like we walked into the store and there were flowers all over in front of the Apple store. And it was Steve Jobs had just died that evening, I guess.
Wow. So maybe, huh. Crazy.
Anyway.
Anyway, music, right?
Well.
Good story, bro.
Ending to that story.
Okay. Yeah. You guys want to get this thing rolling? Get this thing going?
Yeah, let's jam it.
Daniel, real quick, have you heard this record? When was the last time you listened to any of these songs that you wrote together?
I have heard it. Last time I listened to it, I don't know, maybe a year ago or something like that.
Okay, so you're probably closer than all of us potentially.
I still think it, I still really like it. Or last time I listened to it.
Yeah, somebody in the chat earlier asked.
Let's see if we can change your mind real quick.
Now, somebody in the chat earlier asked if there's a good heavy band that you have not been in. Have you been able to find one yet that you haven't been in?
I haven't looked. I think there are many, though. Yeah,
I think there's one or two, but not that many. Yeah. You're, yeah.
I've been in a couple bands, not very many. I like your professional microphone.
Yeah, I'm like a pro now. It's pretty sick.
All right.
It's good.
Cool.
All right,
let's get the thing rolling. Let's go with the first song. So just Matt and Dan, just so you know, we're kind of just I think I talked to Dan, but so we're just gonna kinda listen to the song at a time and kinda talk about it, maybe take some questions from people from the band that are watching the chat, and then you know, just a natural progression. So first track, here we go.
But wait, real quick.
Oh,
yep.
How do I get it where I can see the comments? Or can
Dash,
Grant, send him a link during this song.
Dad, I'll talk to you. I'll text you on the side, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Is there a way to see? Is there a way to see? Is James on here?
Push gallery view on the top so you can see everybody. So it should be on the top of your laptop.
Okay.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Here we go, guys.
Change the view and you'll see everybody.
There it is. Yeah.
Hey, Mama.
Hey.
All right.
Hey. Yeah, I was only seeing like three people.
I really wish I
We gotta get that key. Oh, there we go. Perfect.
Heck yeah.
I would love that.
That sounds tight.
That's the keyboard, that lead bendy keyboard part. That's the part that Josh decided to use, which is pretty sick. No, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Goldman, you made that happen? You like went into the old files and just gave it to him?
Wait, is Goldman muted?
Yeah, so
sorry. No, I just loaned it.
Yeah, loaned it. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And what's funny is there was somebody, August Burns Carl in the chat asked that he wanted to know if there's ever been a feature on an Underoath record or song and have we ever thought about it? And the first technical feature that was Daniel coming in and playing drums on Lost in the Sound, right?
Oh, we did that live. Yeah. Holy shit, I forgot about that. That was tight.
That was.
I remember that played somehow into when we were trying to figure out who was going to play drums. I remember that day in the studio recording Lost coming back up and being like, man, just jamming with Daniel was really cool. We should give him a call. And yeah, it's funny how, comes full circle. Freaking crazy.
Yeah, that was so sick. I think that's the first song. I don't know if it's the first song we wrote, but being that it's first on the album, that's the first song in Underoath history that was not in drop D.
Oh, is that with the baritones?
Yeah,
that's the first song we ever wrote in baritone. No, there was one part on Lost in the Sound prior where we had to drop to like an A for one specific part.
Yeah, one drop A.
That was the first time we ever wrote something in a completely different tuning with completely different guitars. And I remember, I don't know why we got baritones, but I remember writing that riff in that old Falkenberg practice studio. Daniel, we were talking about that earlier, where in Brandon with the AC unit, it was just like an old office. Yeah. The place was so cool. Not really cool at all, but it was memories. But yeah, I remember playing that song in that room almost as it is, with probably a few small tweaks, and just being like, we're just hitting like single notes and just bending and getting sloppy, but it sounded so heavy because everything just slid down the scale. And I feel like that just kind of opened up a lot creatively in my head, going, oh, we don't have to overthink, and we could just shove things over here. And it just created a completely different vibe.
Yeah, I remember in particular when we wrote the chorus for this song, watching James play that riff, he was so pumped to play that riff. He just kept playing it over and over, just like looking at the neck. And that's a mental image I have in my head, him being so
there's pumped. A lot of riffs on this record that just stoked me out still, like whenever I hear them.
Does anyone else remember getting in that freezing cold pool for hours when we shot the video for this?
Yes, there were a couple people that asked about the video in the chat.
Yeah, I remember being upside down on a crane thing, and they sewed my hair to my shirt because at the time I had dreadlocks. That way it didn't look like I was upside down, and I had to. I remember how cold that water was. That was a fun time.
Yeah, that was in a. It was a diving school in.
Scuba.
Yeah, so it was basically a big pool. Yeah.
It was like super deep because I remember half of it we had to shoot way down. They had those scuba divers down there with the oxygen.
Yeah.
Terrifying.
I didn't have to do any of the scary stuff.
That was with Jimmy, right? Jimmy did that video, and he also worked at the studio at the time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, correct.
Yeah, he killed it. I like that video.
Now he's making Call of Duty video games.
He's killing it.
Yeah.
Nice.
Now he's making babies.
Yep.
Right?
That's crazy.
I think I just saw that he's having a kid.
Yep.
Like everybody, cares.
like the world.
I was going to say one thing y'all were talking about earlier, and y'all were talking about remembering playing that song the first time. I remember you were talking about whether you couldn't remember. And obviously, I wasn't there for the writing, but you couldn't remember where this record was at the point at which Aaron stepped out. And you're like, well, what do we do? It seems like I remember Tim and I talked when Tim called me and told me that Aaron had quit. There was, at that point, whether or not this is actually what happened, y'all had decided, I remember you saying, everything we've done so far, we're just dropping it. Now, maybe that some of those ideas came back in. But as far as I remember, you said you were starting from scratch with Daniel. But what was that?
I think we did. I remember that conversation too.
Yeah. And Aaron's right. Like, Sprinkle did come down. We had some material, but I vividly remember I don't know why, but I hear Daniel. I could visually see me seeing Daniel when I listen to most of the songs or think about those songs. And maybe something will trigger as we go back through it. But I just remember Daniel coming down. I remember, you know, we had a couple people hit us up and Daniel was the first call and he's like, yeah, like I'll swing down. We'll see what happens. We actually asked him to fill in for a tour with the hopes that he would want to stick around. And he ended up doing that. And then we wrote the record and like, just writing that record with him was so interesting because it was just an immediate kind of what we were talking about before Daniel got on the call, like with Aaron's wanting the tendency to go this way and then us wanting to go this way. And then when that was removed, like as free as Aaron felt, like when he left, it was almost like, as Chris said, overcompensation, like all this stuff in at least my brain was just able to come out. And Daniel's like, oh, I got a riff for that. I got a beat for that. I got a this for that. And all of a sudden it was just like, boom, 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 boom. And it's just right.
Right.
You know,
I remember being like, crazy. I was kind of like, hey, you sure you want to toss out all the old ideas? Cause I was worried are you going to write enough songs in the span of time you had? And you're like, no, dude, this is, you know, I think it was just, it was obviously a really emotional thing. And it was like, just everything was emotionally charged. And I think it probably just got y'all you just cranked out a ton of jams real fast.
Yeah, that was one thing I remember in particular when Daniel hopped in, is it just happened real quick. Like stuff was, I think that just comes with like having a voice that has not
a new element
been there. Yeah. Like I remember, honestly, I don't even remember the name of the song. It's later on in the record. The working title was Hardee's. And
does anybody know anything but the working titles?
Yeah, Spencer wants us to learn the real titles, but we won't do that.
I hated Hardee's. I still can't listen to that song.
Oh, so heavy.
I love that song.
Dude, Hardee's is so sick.
Hardee's is so sick.
Well, let's talk about Hardee's when we get to Hardee's.
Okay, Grant, let's do the next song.
If I can talk.
Oh, no, go ahead.
I was going to say, my take on that with writing the album, it's kind of like, you know, like Tim was saying, the same way Aaron kind of went his way and was kind of released. Like, it's the same thing with the band with previous, like anytime you have a major change, whether it was Chasing Safety or this album or even like Erase Me, we were away and you have this kind of like open field where it's like, well, the band is completely different. No one expects, you know, anything from us to it in a sense. You have the freedom to do whatever and you just kind of like lean into it. And that's, to me, how this one felt. Like, I think we were on the same page. Like, yo, let's make a heavy fucking record. And, like, not that the other ones weren't, but this one, we just were like, let's make a riffier, heavier record. And, like, when Daniel came in, it just fit. And everyone just kind of leaned in that direction. And, like, it was a very, like you said, quick transition, Chris. To me.
It was sick.
Yeah. It was cool. All right.
I remember it being... I came down because Chris, you were still living in Atlanta, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I rode down with you, and Tim had sent me like 3 demos that I think you programmed the drums to, or it was like programmed drums.
Yeah.
And I got those and like set my drums up in my house and played those songs for 2 or 3 days. And then we rode down and then just immediately started writing as soon as there was like no conversation. I mean, about it was just like, hey, let's start. We played the songs that you had sent me and then immediately just started writing and didn't stop for like 5 weeks or something. It wasn't very long.
If I remember this, weren't you thinking about like doing the record and not necessarily maybe joining the band at that time? Am I right? Or is that I think I remember you coming down, like you were writing the record, but you weren't sure if you were going to join the band yet.
Well, I think it was kind of mutually agreed. It was like, we'll write the record, do the record, and then there was this the one tour or maybe two tours that were you guys already had booked, and it was like we'll do those and then kind of see how everybody feels.
Yeah, and I think you know, speaking to how quick it happened when you came down, I think a lot of that was just because or I guess speaking to how quick we started writing was because we had already known each other for so long that there was I don't think anybody felt like there was we needed like an acclimation period. It was just like, hey, we've known you forever. We've never written music together. So let's just see how that works. And it just kind of happened, which I think is sick.
Yeah. Yeah. It was super fun.
Word. All right. Let's move on to the next.
Take us there.
The next song.
Sick. I have to say, I think that the drums on the bridge of that song are probably my favorite drums on the whole record. I remember when we were working on that bridge, just trying to figure out like what the drums are doing, and I remember just being like, oh yeah, maybe I could just do like this like crazy like fast thing. I love that. That's so sick.
I remember James is like, dude, that's like a Mars Volta drum beat. Or like,
and you're like, oh, thanks.
Yeah, I was like, sweet. All right, I like that,
dude. I mean, listening to that song, all I hear is Glassjaw and Relationship of Command. I vividly remember, I would say vividly, but I actually remember that being like a pull from that so hard, even with like the da-na-na-na-na-na-na-na, like all those little tricks were like these nods to like Beck and like At the Drive-In and everything that was happening in like that world. And like, there's not much on that song that isn't that. And the chorus is very like Thursday, but really heavy. And it's just, that song is just everything that we grew up listening to, but never actually executed on in Underoath until that song. And it's just blatantly obvious to me. Maybe that's a good thing. Maybe that's a bad thing. But
the working title, the working title for this song was Glassjaw, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, no one was called Glassjaw, and one of them
another one was called ATDI. That's the one that starts with the songs, just like Relationship does.
Yeah, that one's like, whoa, that's a little too close.
Oh yeah, it was literally called At the Drive-In. Little did we know, Goldman was using that writing style 2 months later on a 68 record.
I think awesome. I remember
song was one of the first three that you sent me, Tim, that had like programmed drums. And I think some of the drums, I just basically did what you sent because it made sense.
Cool. I just remember starting that song with that rolling bass line. And then building everything off that. Like that bass line rolls throughout the whole thing. And I just, in my head, thought that was so cool and like not unique, but unique to us. And I just ran with it. And even on the guitars, like I remember sitting with Matt and everything, if you listen to that in stereo and pull one AirPod out, like both guitars are just fighting intentionally to make it just a noise.
Yeah, I remember that being, I don't want to call it work, but I remember being really deliberate because it was our tendency to want to like, oh, well, obviously the guitar has to play the riff, obviously. And we had to fight the wanting to play the riff and just let the bass do it and then dance around it. It was
find stuff around it.
Yeah.
And then also find another one that doesn't do anything that the other one did. For no other reason than that's just what I wanted in my head. And we're like, we'll just sit here until we get it.
Spencer, someone asked actually in the chat if you could go into any kind of detail on the lyrics for that song at all. Just out of curiosity.
It was 10 years ago, so I'm trying to think. I was in a pretty weird. I mean, that was like the deepest of deep of when I was pretty far into like drug addiction at that time. I remember sleeping in the upstairs of the studio. Till like while everyone else was working on music just to catch up on sleep because I was like so hungover. And that song was like, I remember visually trying to explain like battling the demons in my brain. You know, what was that song was? That's like that whole ending about like, I finally got them where I want them. Like, I'm not talking about people. I was talking about what was going on inside my head, like trying to get rid of the demons I was battling at the time. And for many, many, many years prior and a few years after that, making that record.
Yeah, the lyrics on this album are dark as hell.
Yeah.
Like, dark.
That was the worst I've ever felt in my life. That from 2010 to like 13 or 14, it was pretty brutal. But yeah, that was dark times.
I remember specifically lugging a Bass Rhodes up to the studio for the bridge of the song, trying to like fit it in the song and then getting denied because Chris plays keys. And I think it stayed in your studio for like 4 or 5 years, Matt, didn't it? Didn't it like stay up there?
I don't even remember. So many different things get left at the studio that I lose track.
I still don't know where
it is. I left some drums there that, Matt, you like called me or texted me about like 6 months ago, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it was probably like 2 years ago, but
Matt hit, was looking for some drums for his kid. It was like, you want to let him use these? And it's like, yeah, you're cool. So yeah. We all know you're cool. Yeah.
That's awesome.
We also showed a video for this in your studio, like a live video.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about
that. Yeah, those were cool. I remember those.
Yeah, that was cool.
With the circle.
I,
think, yeah.
I feel like that's how a band should do Twitch live streams now.
Just track.
Just a band jamming with a camera going around.
We each have our own camera going around us.
Yeah, totally.
I can just do this with my iPhone.
Like the workout outside, Grant?
Oh, yeah.
All right, Grant. Track three. Hit track us.
Three.
I don't even know what this song is. Oh, it's Paper Lung, I think.
Yes, it is Paper Lung.
Anybody remember the working title?
Oh.
No, what was it?
It wasn't a quiz.
Oh.
I remember Daniel's Papier Loom.
Oh, yeah.
Papier Loom.
All right.
Yeah.
That ending.
God, that's probably the heaviest ending of a song we've ever done. If I had to,
so fun live. Playing that ending.
Oh man,
Oh yeah.
There was quite a few people in the chat during that song that were asking about the video for this song in particular.
Dude, you guys remember how cool that was? Like, that was freezing. In Montreal, so it was like negative something. They had those like little heat zip up things we had to sit in just to warm up.
It was Montreal in the middle of winter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have. Yeah, Jodeb killed that thing. I remember. Oh, go ahead, Speed.
I remember you guys got to leave after a couple hours, and I had to stay for like another eight by myself, just freezing my ass off.
I still think that's one of it might be my favorite video that we have. Like that one and probably Writing on the Walls are my two favorite videos I have. Jodeb is just so awesome. Somebody asked Chayton Meow in the chat asked how we got hooked up with him, and that was all Daniel, right?
Yeah, yeah, so. He had, I was working with this Canadian band, doing some management stuff. He had hit me up regarding them, and they had recently done a video, so they didn't have a budget to do another one, but we were actually just starting to look for a director for this video. I was like, told him who I was and that I was playing with you guys, and he was like, oh, like, Underoath's one of my favorite bands. And like, when he reached out to me, he didn't know that I was playing with you guys or anything like that. And he's like, yeah, let's do it. We'll make it happen. Even though he was doing like Deftones and he had just, I remember I was staying at Grant's house when we were writing and the You've Seen the Butcher video came out that he did.
That video is so sick.
Yeah, it's insane.
But, and that was a huge inspiration on the record. That the Diamond Eyes, I remember, at least for me and you, Daniel, like talking about Diamond Eyes, our love for Deftones our whole lives. But I remember that record had come out right before we got in the studio. Me and you talked about moments on that, trying to get those kind of moments in this record. I could definitely hear that in Paper Love for sure. Like,
oh, for sure.
Deftones.
Yeah. I remember, I think the day. I don't know if it was the day it came out, but it was right around there, like listening to it in your car, Diamond Eyes, and just like in your driveway. And we're like, this is insane. Like for several different parts on that record.
Yeah. There was also a couple people in the chat. Nep TV Knee Noise was one of them. We're asking about the vocal sample in the intro and wanted to know what it was. And that was, I remember I wanted some sort of talking there and I couldn't remember. I couldn't figure out what to do. So I just asked Spencer for just pages of lyrics. And then I just, I think I just with Matt for like a few minutes in the B room, we just read through lyrics and then we unused just picked. Lyrics. Yeah. Just unused lyrics. Yeah. And then we pitched them down a little bit. I think that's all that was.
An iPad that had some new stuff on it. You messed around with a good bit. I can't remember if that was that.
No, that was on the last song. The intro to the last song, Catching Myself. I had Spencer. We went into the hallway of the studio and I had my iPad and I had an app on it. And I just asked him to yell that one line. And then I was able to like manipulate it and do all kinds of fun stuff. I don't even remember the name of the app, which I feel dumb.
Yeah, I feel like I'd love to use it again. I think that song, if I remember correctly, was kind of a, I don't want to say it was a struggle, but I remember especially like Tim, because I think we roomed together making that. You were having a super hard time with the chorus because it was guitar wise, it's super simple, but it still comes off super heavy. I remember that being like a struggle, but it fit the vocals so well. And there was just this like, dynamic where you're like, dude, this song just isn't doing it for me. But I'm curious, not to put you on the spot, but like looking back now and listening to it now, do you think that it's like, how is that view, like how's that fit for you now?
I think it fits really well. I think I naturally just do that all the time. I mean, anything that's obvious or less interesting than the part before it, I just lose interest, even if it's the perfect part and it's like fits like a glove. I'm like, I want the glove to be either be really tight or really loose and be like different. That's just the way my brain works. But like listening back to it now, I remember fighting on that. I remember there were like more harmonies. It was like, there was like this whole conversation of, you know, I did a very bad job of trying to prove my point, but I just remember being like, mute all the music, like play the vocal, like that could be anyone. And it's like, I remember there was like three part harmonies and then we ended up going with two to make it darker and we didn't go with the major one. And it was like kind of a compromise, but I think listening back and the way the whole song took shape around that, like that's the one part that made sense to be more melodic in retrospect for sure.
Yeah. Cool. Sick.
I feel like that one changed. I feel like the chorus changed a decent amount in the studio. Like,
that was a different song. That chorus only happened once. And when I wrote the vocal part, I remember me and you talking about it. And you're like, yeah, we should do it again. I think we actually did a little pre-production on that song, which we normally didn't do. I remember that. Because the end was going to be like,
yeah, I have distinct memories of playing that one in the studio, not recording it, but like in that, I feel like we had a week on the beginning of before the session actually started recording, before we started recording.
We spent some number of days going through all the songs, just playing the songs and bringing out transitions and parts and whatever. Yeah. But vocals hadn't been written yet. I remember there's one song that we ended up cutting because is Jeremy not going to be here tonight?
He texted me kind of last minute, so I don't think he's going to make it, but yeah.
Gotcha. Because I remember there's one song, Jeremy and I were kind of like, man, I just don't think this is happening. And I don't remember what the working title was.
What's the point? What's the point?
Yeah.
We called it What's the Point because we couldn't figure out what to do with it.
And Jeremy and I were like, the thing to do with this song is delete it.
Is Control Alt Z. I still remember that.
Oh yeah.
It's like, great. Yeah. And now what? And we were like, make it louder.
But then I don't know. I think maybe maybe it's later on the record. The one that y'all ended up writing, because we were like, hey, y'all just jammed tonight.
Wrote it that night. Yeah.
You wrote Spend It.
Yeah. Yeah. That's one of my favorites on the record.
Yeah.
Same.
Let's see. What's the next one up? You guys ready?
Do it.
Illuminator.
Do it.
Ooh. I love playing that last riff live.
Yeah, me too.
I love it. I love it with all my heart.
That was so sick.
That's probably my favorite song on the record, I think.
Yeah, that thing was awesome. I've always really loved the thing right down the thing right before the breakdown, the blah da 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 la da da da, and then with
oh, somebody clip that, please.
Oh, yeah, that's gonna be my new money gift.
that song also reminds me of is. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
No, okay. You go ahead.
The keys and the chorus or the synth or whatever it is, I love that.
Awesome, thanks. I do too, but I'm biased, so.
Yeah. No, that chorus, in general, I think is super rad. I remember, Tim, you were like, you had this idea to reverse the, like, what each part of the drum kit did. It was like, I'm not going to be able to explain it, but it was just like mixing up instead of like, I'm not going to be able to explain it, but that thought just popped in my head where you were like, what if we mixed up and did a very non-traditional beat for the chorus. And I think it worked really well.
Yeah, and the beat is actually traditional, but it's just not on the traditional instruments. But another thing that made me think about that is that reminds me of the first thing you did on Lost in the Sound with us, when you played those aux toms. And I think it was on whatever the beat is, it's not the same. But yeah, like the end of Desperate Times, like, I remember seeing you in the studio with us and I like videoing it and like just hearing that chorus. It's like, that's the first thing we did together, like a record prior. And it was like, just a more thought out version. And I'm just like, dude, that's really cool. I like that song a lot.
Yeah. It's a very eerie feel on the chorus though. I love that vocally.
Yeah.
Especially.
That's my favorite one off that record too.
Yeah. I was going to say, I think when Aaron came back, when we were talking about, what songs we wanted to play from this record, I think that was your choice, right, Aaron? You said you wanted to play this one.
Yeah, first choice, because I don't know if you guys remember, but we've played Paper Long too, but I that song in particular, the end, like Tim, I think Tim just said he loves to play that part live, and I love we added that thing, I can't describe it, and then I had Grant with me just go bow 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 on the end.
Oh, that was floor.
Yeah, dude, that ending is so fucking good. That song in particular is so cool. Like,
yeah, we still play that when we headline.
Yeah, yeah, that. I've played that song a lot in the last 4 or 5 years. I love that song.
Was that a song that we had, that one of the ones that we had with you, like we're working with you before, or no?
No, there's only a couple little parts on this whole record that I remember playing to, and I know they're deeper in the record. When we get there, I know it'll jog my memory when we get deeper into it, but no, definitely not this.
I can remember the end of, I can't remember the name. Who Will Guard the Guardians? That's the one we wrote in the studio, right? Completely.
We put it together.
At least in the studio. I think the end of that one, I remember y'all talking about, that was a breakdown y'all had played live even.
Yeah, yep. That is. That was like one of the only parts that we kept, I think. That was
There's a video of that breakdown from, we played that live, like as a part of like a,
at like Skate and Surf or something like that?
No. Soundwave. There's a video, and there's this whole musical thing on the out of a song, and there's that part that Daniel's talking about, and it's so different than it is on the record, and I'm so glad that it made it the way that it is on the record as opposed to the way that it was on that video. But it's some version of that. It's really cool. It's that version is not as good as the record version, but
yeah, I think it's on a tour video, like an old tour video, I think Brent shot of Soundwave.
Can we play that? Can we look it up?
Oh man, it'd be so
after that song,
it.
Of course.
I don't know how to use this. I don't computer well, Daniel.
This one, that last song, I think was also one of the first, one of the three that you sent me, Tim, initially. Very different.
That might be. Yeah.
Almost certain that we had that riff with Aaron and we changed it, but I'm almost certain you had that riff and we just changed the whole thing. If we just,
you know,
like,
what? I think you might be right, because the second part of the verse where it kicks in the bow, 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 I think that's where we were going with it. And then Daniel came in and added the blast beat kind of converging part.
Yeah, I remember you or Grant wanting me to go na 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 na, and me being like, oh, that's interesting. Like, it's kind of like a blast beat, but not. And then that's as much as I can remember of it. But I do now.
We might have actually started that.
Yeah. Now that you're saying the blast beat thing was a thing when I was there, but I remember not getting any further than that. And then,
yeah, it was like just remember. That riff. And then we just like hit open. I don't know. It was nothing after that.
Emptiness. Yeah. It was nothing.
Yeah. I don't think the blast beat was something that I like added. I think that was something that was on the program thing that you sent me, but
so that might've been from Aaron. Yeah.
When it transitions into the more just like kind of punk beat, I remember you being, that was something that I did, and you were like, oh yeah, that makes it more, instead of like blast beaty kind of whatever style, more of like a Refused type feel.
Yep, for sure.
And then kind of like followed that train.
Yeah, it was sick.
Tight. Sweet.
What's this next song we got?
Just lay it on us. I don't.
Okay.
I don't know what it is.
It's heavy.
It's the working title.
We'll go back. Did it again. I did it again.
Aren't you the president? What the fuck is your problem?
So
you did this last stream too.
I did. Jesus. Yeah, third stream, I'll get the whole record straight. I'll remember it actually.
If you do this next week, you're done.
I'm going to be what, vice president, or what am I going to be?
I don't know. I'm gonna learn internet and become the king.
That was out of order, correct?
It was, yeah. Sorry.
Yeah.
I just hit play on Spotify.
When you said it was heavy, I was like, are we there already?
That's the heaviest song we've ever written, right?
I got a little riff boner when I saw the name and I just hit play. I'm sorry.
That
what can I say?
Song is so sick.
Daniel, I'm gonna need to tab out for the time signature for the beginning because
it took me like a whole day at the practice. I mean, this is how I remember it, at least. I feel like I went to the practice studio alone to like learn it because we spent like hours and I couldn't get it. But then when I finally did, it's like so simple. Is that right?
Yeah,
is
no, for sure. And yeah. I remember Spencer when he was working on the vocals for this. That was a hiccup during that part too.
I remember like kind of having to conduct. We had to figure out where do the vocals go even.
Yeah.
And I remember counting.
I'm so mad. Like,
now. And yeah, it was kind of, it felt silly for something so heavy to be so, when we were doing it, it felt a little contrived, but it was just,
yeah.
It hadn't been internalized yet. And so it was just, it had to be practiced. And it was so weird. So Tim, did you, when you wrote it, were you like trying like, I'm gonna write a weird riff, or was it just in your head?
Yeah. I mean, I remember it wasn't like I wrote that riff and I was like, here's the riff, here's the tabs. Like, I remember it was an evolving thing, but I remember when all those stabs came into a revolution, I was like, that's it. And then I remember Daniel being like, what's it? And then it was just like we were flamming. And then all of a sudden everyone's like, well, I'm going to go pee real quick. And then me and Daniel are still working on it. And then everyone's like sitting down on the ground and everyone's like, should we leave? And I'm like, no, you have it. But just that one. He's like, which one? And I'm like, it's just on the end. And I don't know how to talk about music. So I'm just like, it's the da-da instead of the uh-uh. And he's just like, what are you talking about? But literally like that next day we came in and he hit it. And I remember him looking at me, just like rolled his eyes. Like, this is so dumb. Like, once you get it, it's like, he said, it's so easy. Mm-hmm. But even playing to it just now, like in my head, I hit a snare and I was like, that's the wrong snare. Like, coming back to it, I'm like, I'm confused. Like, that is a really weird riff. But I remember working on it thinking, if we get it, it will be sick. And this song's working title is called Meshurge.
yeah, I remember that.
Meshuggah and Converge, I think. but I think that was kind of the vibe of like just those tricks. And then, yeah, it threw everyone for a loop. And I'm not saying I had it clearly at all. I think it all threw us for a loop. And then once we had it, it was like once Daniel got it, everyone else was just like, we could get through it. And then everyone caught it as we went, for sure.
You guys remember?
I literally texted Spee on the side and just said, can you explain this to me? Because no one ever has.
Dude, I even remember the lyrics. Like, the performance is great on the record, but if I remember being in the studio, like, no, it's between motionless and I don't know when I. And it was just this really like marching bandy feeling thing. But like, once we all got it, like the song locks in really well.
It's cool. Do you guys ever play it as a band?
Yeah, I was just going to say that. You guys remember playing it? We did it on a tour, the whole tour. Do you remember the first like 3 times we played it, one of us messed up every like for like a week straight. At least one of us messed up during that part.
I loved playing that song because when it goes to like the upbeat part, the like whatever that thing is when the tambourine comes in, that was so fun to play.
Don't y'all text me some shit about we're gonna play this song. Just so you know.
This could be the first song I want to play once we get out of this lockdown thing, man.
I'm gonna fly your boy back out here, dude.
I'm on it.
I'll be outside for that part.
He'll get in this camper. He'll hop in. Let's get it.
Yeah, I'll meet you there. Hook the camper up to the bus.
A cool thing about that song is I remembered that lyric, where is my fix, where is my fix. I remembered it forever since I first heard the record in 2010. And if you listen to Erase Me, Spencer and I went back and reused that. There is no fix, there is no fix. Yeah. Our first headlining tour back on the new record was called the No Fix Tour. after that song.
Yeah, which is pretty cool. And also a fun little fact is, what's the first song on this record called? Damn it.
In Division,
and then Incompletion is the last song. And then there's a song on Erase Me called In Motion. And they kind of conclude each other. And that's the one that he's talking about that has there is no
fix. Yeah, there is no fix.
Easter egg for
I remember us sitting and writing In Motion, and I was like, what about that line from that one song? The ones I remember specifically saying, the one with the fucked up time signature. It's funny.
So that's where the ends come from. Those three songs are kind of
weird.
So what song did we skip?
Driftwood. We skipped Driftwood. So
let's play it, Grant.
Go back three spaces and play Driftwood. Slightly different vibe.
Slightly different vibe.
I forgot this goes right into the next one too. That's why that was so cool.
Yeah, that's why that was cool.
Yeah, you blew it, Grant. Gosh.
Don't hate me.
I like that song. That song's cool.
Yeah. That's one of my favorites on the record for sure.
Yeah, same.
Yeah, it was really cool.
Same. The bass line, Grant, do you remember what happened with that bass line? Was that Jeremy, who's not here? Is that the bass that was out of tune?
Yeah, it was like an out of tune.
That was the McCartney bass.
Yeah, it sounded like crap, but in an awesome way. And we're like,
you trapped it in the B room, right?
Yeah.
Yep. You did, Tim. You tracked it.
Yeah, I remember. Like we pulled Goldman, as Goldman does, has Daniel's drums, Grant's bass, Rhodes, all of Chris's riffs on hard drives everywhere. There's like so much stuff there, and I remember there was this bass, and I remember we wanted it to feel not like a normal bass and like tinny and kind of toy sounding and more mid-range, and we grabbed, what was it, Grant, what kind of bass was it?
It was like
a Paul McCartney or something.
The Paul McCartney.
I think it might have just been a P bass, but I think it had flat wounds on it.
No, was that
the one that was like wearing around the studio the whole time? Remember, I would wear that bass around, and I'd play it up here.
I don't remember.
I followed Chris around a lot with that thing.
Speed would walk around being like, beat people up if they play this bass. Like, he was just making jokes all the time.
I was just following Chris around with that bass everywhere. Remember that, Chris?
I remember.
But I remember we picked it up off the wall and just found the root note, and none of the notes were in tune. I don't even know what tuning we recorded it in, but like wherever our hands went,
I think I know
they
what
just,
that was.
It
was
literally
bass,
just
but I think I know what it was.
The ugly one. Yeah. It was the ugly one.
It was ugly. I remember that. There was
Chris, you got a lot of sample questions on this one.
Yeah. Well, actually, Prince Simba said, I want to know Daniel's thoughts behind the drums on this song. Daniel, was this one of the songs that you recorded in the B room with like that one microphone?
Yeah, I think you were like, hey, I'm working on this. Because we hadn't really written this one. It was a studio thing.
Yeah,
I think. And I remember you coming to grab me and you were like, hey, come in here. I think one like rooms mic, and there wasn't even anything to play to that I can remember. It was just like play a simple beat and like a few different things. And then it was, I think with Chris, it was you and Jeremy in there, mm-hmm. if I'm remembering correctly. And then he took some stuff and like double timed. Those fast drums were like drums that I had played.
It was all edited. Like, yeah. I forget exactly how it all came together.
Yeah. It blew my mind.
Definitely a concoction of Chris's and Jeremy's. Jeremy had a pretty big hand in this.
Mm-hmm.
And some of what might sound like samples, some of the crazy glitchy vocal things was a chaos pad that we just recorded. You know, we actually just printed the effect back in. So I think that would be something that some people would hear as samples, but it's not. I guess technically it's a sample that we made of the vocal and manipulated.
Yeah.
And then, Chris, do you want to talk about that beginning sample?
Yeah. I honestly don't remember where all of that stuff came from. I remember.
Probably got it from a 68 record.
Yeah, right.
that was a sad
demo.
Yeah, that gets me. You should be the one that would want to talk about it or not, but that was, Tim took a
gosh, I literally can't believe I don't remember that. I didn't remember that. So yeah, so
all while, the stuff in the beginning.
Yeah, so while we were making this, I can't believe I must have blocked that out. That's crazy. So while we were making this record, no it's the beginning of this song. While we were recording this record, my stepdad passed away unexpectedly. And he was, you know, basically my dad. He raised me from the time I was 9, and he passed away during this. And Tim, because the funeral was during the making of this record and everybody flew down to the funeral. And Tim had taken a voice note on his phone of just the reception area of all the people just kind of like walking around and talking. Okay. I ended up putting that in as the sample, that like when you hear like those people talking and kids running around and stuff, that's at my stepdad's funeral, which that's crazy that I lost that out of my brain. But
I didn't know you guys were making this record. I was there at the funeral and I had no idea you guys were making this record then. That's really interesting. Too.
Yeah, that was not fun times.
No, it was bad time.
Yeah.
That was bad.
I remember
time.
Being at the Earl.
Yep.
That was weird.
Yeah,
that was a weird day.
Yeah, I was gonna rent a car and just drive home that night, but I didn't really know what I was doing. And then you guys were like, "No, we'll get you a flight." And I was just like, "No, I'll just drive." And you guys were like, "No, you're not doing that." And I was like, "Okay, whatever you say."
Yeah, that's cool.
But yeah.
So what's the next song, Grant? Being that you already,
I know, I just started thinking about Taqueria del Sol all of a sudden when you started talking about
Taqueria. We can talk about that next week too.
Some Fellini's, Taqueria.
Oh, Atlanta, Little Five Pizza. Miss you.
Earl, God.
Woo. Earl.
The Earl is the best burger in America. Fact.
Oh, God. This is awesome.
Atlanta's so good. All right. Grant, play the a song. Next song is actually the one we wrote in the studio. Who Will Guard the Guardians?
Ooh. Or Spinning O'Brien.
Or Spending O'Brien, yep.
Yes.
Gosh. Spending O'Brien.
Yeah.
Gosh.
All right. Here we go.
That song is dope.
That song is so sick.
I forgot how good that was.
Man, I
the
love
drum grooves on that song are so sick.
Man, playing that song too. Oh,
yeah.
I would want to pick up the stage and break it over my knee every night playing that song. Oh.
Yeah, that song was great. And that all came from Goldman showing us No Quarter in the studio. We were jamming on that for a while and just building off of that.
Even listen to Tool's cover of No Quarter, to be exact. That was sick, too.
I forgot about that.
Yeah, it was like the outtakes. I think we're listening to some of the Zeppelin outtakes. It was like a demo of their demo of No Quarter and the vibe it had. I think Spencer kind of borrowed something from that at some point in that song.
Yeah, and that one like was kind of lyrically like the where I picked up from the record before Emergency Broadcast. It was kind of like that was I don't know. I just had this fascination with a lot of like apocalyptic end of time shit, because maybe that's just how shit felt in my life at that period of my 20s or whatever. But like that was kind of the next step in that kind of little story in my brain, even though there was no like there's never been like a concept record or anything for Underoath, but that was kind of like a sequel lyrically to that song.
I love that machines built by machines built by machines lyric. The lyrics
on that whole song are sick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like wasn't that when we started writing that, when we finally, or maybe I finally gave up because the song was literally called What's the Point at the point in which it got erased off the whiteboard. But didn't we need like 10 songs and we had 9 ideas and What's the Point was just floating? And at some point it's like, Matt and Jeremy were like, boys, you got to throw that pile of crap out and just get to work. And that's when we kind of went on the deep dive. And then literally in a night, that song was written.
Yep.
Yeah, it was like not during the day at the studio. It was like we had done the day at the studio. Matt and Jeremy
super late.
Went home and we stayed there late into the night and somehow came up.
I remember before Matt left, we asked him to like wire it up. Like we recorded it. Like they came in the next day with like a demo of the song. And they were like, what is this? For
hours.
And we were just like, that's what we wrote last night. And they're like, all right, let's go.
Do you remember, like, I remember being a big deal to use that like that guitar tone at the beginning to make your guitar less heavy for the record. I love that tone, whatever it is in the beginning. And I remember that was like you probably don't really notice as a listener, but to us was a big deal because it was like, I don't know, like a boutique amp that wasn't like super.
Because then when it kicks in with the
it's a different amp.
That's
there.
Like the normal tone.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of cool stuff on that. And that outro is from tours prior that we wrote with Aaron on like during sound checks and ended a bunch of shows with. And then
I've been trying to find that shit this whole time. I can't find it. It doesn't exist.
In the comments, somebody put up a link to it. I didn't click on it, but there's a YouTube link to it somewhere in the comments.
It's a video update. Brent took it.
The footage I'm thinking of is from Australia. There's like it's a huge festival. Yeah, I just don't know where it is.
Yeah, Cody, I don't remember what amp that was. Cody H630. We had a bunch of amps in the studio at that point.
Yeah,
I don't remember. The primary ones were my 800 and James's JMP.
James's JMP has been the primary one of every record since he owned that JMP.
Does it still live? Does the JMP still live?
Where is that? That's a good question. Where is that? Is that your studio, Goldman?
No, I got a different.
It's right next to Grant's Bass Roads.
Yeah, somewhere. Floating around in storage space somewhere.
I'm sure it's in the storage space, right?
Yeah.
Brand, quick question. If you're watching it, like when I point to you, do people see me pointing at you? Is this like Brady Bunch?
Yes.
Like I can look down at James? Okay, cool.
But that's Spencer Bowie.
You're not next to him.
Tim, you're right there for me. Wait.
This is James.
Spencer.
That's Grant.
That's backwards for me. It's the other way around.
Spencer. Grant?
Oh, Daniel, you're at the bottom. Daniel, you're way down here for me.
You're at the top for me, Tim, right there.
Dude, I've always been at the top for you, dude.
one more thing I thought about today. Was this the record where the moon boots were both in effect, or is that the next
one? No, next record. Next.
That was Lips Off.
The one before. I can't wait to talk about moon boots. Let's save that shit. Save it.
We'll save it for an appropriate record.
Oh, God.
This was Matt, what was the place next to your studio at the end of the at the strip? That
the jungle?
Jungle.
Wasn't it Banana Slings at one point?
The Wild Mustangs.
Wild Mustangs.
The Mustangs were just a little bit. It's all gone now. Yeah. I mean, the building's there, but it's all different stuff.
Oh, man.
I will never forget that parking lot. We spent so much time in front of the studio hanging out against that brick wall.
Goldman, do you do you still have that console that was in that place?
The one that was there that you that was there during Lost the Sound is there. I got a different one that I don't have anymore. That the Sphere is the one I got after the Trident. The Sphere was awesome. But when it came time to move, I was like, you know, I'm just gonna sell this and not worry about storing it or whatever.
That's a lot, yeah.
It was awesome.
Did you sell that to somebody in Chicago? I feel like you
hit
me up at some point about driving it. You were like, yeah, coming to Chicago was when I lived in Chicago.
Yeah. So I told a dude, like, in Chicago, like, you know, like Alpharetta is Atlanta. You know, it was like an hour from the city.
Mm.
But yeah, now I've got an old Yamaha that's pretty cool. Modded the crap out of it, and it works all right. It's no Sphere, but it's
sick. I get new stuff. Modded up, I like it. Nice.
I love.
Dude, mods. Mod me up with that next song, Dad.
All right, let me make sure I click the right one. You know, I don't want that to happen again.
Is this ATDI?
It's reversal, I think.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Some dude named Chris saying Genie ate my life. Genie ate my life.
TV is my life. I saw that one.
Chuck Danson said, it's funny because he says the production on this is flawless, so good. And I remember this song in particular, what the drums were set up in the B room, and it was one microphone.
One mic.
And it was three drums, right? It was just a snare, a kick, and a hi-hat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we were just like, hey, just compress the crap out of it. And then,
dude. And I tracked that bass line in the B room as a demo through a Sansamp plugin dry.
Yes.
There was one drum mic and me just going down, 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 down. And we were going for like the Beastie Boysy, like weird, gross, Frotus thing. And then we got to like retrack it. And Matt kind of did his, like, if I remember correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, just like, I mean, it sounds kind of cool. Or just like, exactly. Leave it. I just threw some feedback over it and just printed it.
Were we ever going
the
like.
The bass is insane.
Yeah, love we were it. Going like it's that song, like in a direction. Like, yeah. I know we were like wanting, I think at one point we were trying to make that into something more than it was. And we kind of just were like.
It was supposed to be like a transitional,
like
track.
A bridge piece. I don't know.
Like we were listening to like Tool and Perfect Circle, Daniel. Like those little moments we talked about, like those weird tracks where like the vocal is super weird. And that was at least in my brain. That's what that was supposed to be. It was like some sort of transitional piece. Because we had never, Underoath never really had that besides the blue note. And I was like, dude, that's so sick. Yeah, I think it was just exciting because someone else in the band listened to Tool Perfect Circle and stuff like that. We nerd out about that kind of shit all the time. But I don't think that was ever supposed to go anywhere.
Aside from talking about the drums and the bass, that's all that is. And it just goes for a good solid 90 seconds, it's over.
I think that's the cool thing about it is like most of those kind of tracks we've done before, we'd always kind of, it was definitely like Chris focused. And that was like a kind of a in-between or whatever you want to call it, an individual track that was music, like more musical played, and it was cool.
Yeah, an interlude that actually had some sort of, I don't know, it was like not just Chris,
Yeah.
It's cool.
Yes.
That's some real Chris. Instruments on
Screw
it.
Screw you.
Chris, we don't. Chris.
You're out.
Some real musicians on this mug, dude.
All right. Let's go. Let's move on to the next one here.
Shut
So, so Ma Bell 83 actually said, I think this would have been a great opening song for the album, which it, we had talked about that, right?
Oh yeah, for sure. I know we talked about that being, at least the single originally. I remember that.
We opened a tour with it.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, we did. That was awesome. I
That's
have
the first time I ever saw there. The first time I ever saw Underoath not being in the band, you guys played that first.
I have a vivid cool. memory of
it.
I was playing that.
Dude, we bit at the drive-in so hard on that intro. It's so sick.
Yeah, we did.
Unabashedly, we owe them royalties. Fact.
I remember in the recording process, even like being pushing how close to One Arm Scissor was, and just being like, is it too close now? Do we need to back it off a little bit?
Yeah.
Further.
Even like the lead, someone asked, like, what was the treatment on that? And it's like, in my brain, I was like, once Daniel laid that part, I couldn't creatively come up with a new thought. And I'm like, it's got to be something, but it can't be too something. So we just made noise and just I remember Matt being like, nope, we need one more pedal, man, that's way too close. We just jacked it up and I was like, is that good? And then we just moved on.
Jacob in the chat says two-armed scissor.
Fair enough. That scissor only has two arms for sure.
No arms.
That end is one of my favorite parts is that end after everything goes and we hit that like that whole progression, and then when we kick in heavy, that programming thing you did over that, that whatever that is, like,
yeah,
that ending's really, really cool.
I remember initially for that ending, we were like set on that being a guitar part, and I was set up in the A room. And I was messing around with the thing and I was like, play something like this. And I had like a keyboard thing. And I remember specifically this part, you were like, well, I'm not going to try to do anything else, cause that's like that. It should just be that thing. And we ended up putting that keyboard part in that, like that lead thing.
Yeah. That lead part's cool.
Yeah, it is.
So somebody cool. Can't take me. Jordan plus Cretus.
Oh, please. Get out of here, Jordan. Take him.
Take me. Take all of me, Jordan. Take
you
me,
guys please. See what they were saying? Did you guys see what they were saying to impeach Grant?
Impeach. Can't be
Grant. Done. Grant doesn't even believe in coronavirus.
I just scrolled back and saw that.
This is gonna be huge, guys. You can't take me down.
Oh, so
I'm untouchable up here.
Matt, have you listened to any of these songs since then? Like, do you listen to records that you record?
Some. We talked about this. Were you not, was, I guess maybe before you jumped on, we talked about how I hadn't listened to this much since we made it. And then I listened to it just a few days ago. Cause when Grant calls, hey, you want to do this thing? I was like, I should listen to that record. And so, yeah, I did for the first time in a long time, just a few days ago. I was like, man, A, it's really good. And B, I don't remember how we did half of this stuff.
Dude,
so, I saw somebody asked me about how did you get the drums like that. I was like, man, I don't remember.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember the B room stuff with the one mic, but there's a lot of stuff we did in the A room. We did all sorts of different stuff, but I don't remember from section to section what we did.
I was in the B room like most of the time. Like,
yeah, you and Jeremy were in there writing a ton.
I would demo the vocal. I sang these songs like three times. Like I was singing like 6 hours a day or something, like just nonstop in there. Once we had enough to get started, once you guys got like two songs in on guitar, bass, drums, I was tracking. Mm. And I would demo it out and then I would do it for real.
Yeah, that was like you and Chris's room.
Was that the song that you had written a way popular vocal?
Yeah, you said that we just deleted the catchiest thing on the record. But
Jeremy wrote a really great chorus, and everybody's like, no, too poppy. And Jeremy and I are like, oh my gosh, it's so good.
Yeah, I had six choruses for that song.
Go ahead and sing it to us.
I don't remember it. There's Preaches.
Yep. You listen to
it. Yeah. Dude, I've hung out with that cat so much.
I remember having So after I finished tracking drums, I set a kit up in the B room. And after we were finished, or if there was nothing going on in the B room, I was over there practicing, learning songs for the tour that started like less than a week after. I think it was only a few days after we finished recording.
Real soon after.
Chris would be in that B room early and you when you're practicing, because I wouldn't start tracking till like after 4 or 5 because I would be sleeping.
Yeah, I feel like they were like 2 days off, and this could be exaggerated, but this is how I remember it. Like 2 days off in between writing and starting recording in Atlanta, and then like 2 days off from the last day in the studio until that tour started. Does anybody remember that?
I remember it being a very short period of time, but
we practiced in the studio. Didn't we practice in the tracking room? Like for the tour? I thought we had a practice at the end.
Dude, I can't believe we did that stuff back then.
I remember my first show, I think that tour started in Florida. And I had already been like super nervous because I had never even played to a click before. And I got used to it in the studio, but then it was like, oh, we're going to do that live too. And then getting used to that, and then in Orlando, I think is where it started. Right before we were going on, that computer crapped out so that we didn't have click at that show.
That was in Atlanta at the Tab, I think. Because that was that As LA Dying tour, right?
I remember that.
It was that tour, but I remember it at House of Blues in Orlando for some reason.
Could have been.
The cool tour.
10 years ago.
Just a decade ago. No big deal.
We were writing it this time of the year too. I think we started recording in June. I think.
Man.
Sure. Yeah, sure.
That's a freaking decade, man. That's crazy. All right, Grant, what do we got? What do we got up on deck?
Where are we at? Are we at the end here?
Hardee's. We got Hardee's.
Hardee's is next. Oh, yeah. Yes.
That's it. Why was Hardee's? Why was that the
bathroom break now, Speed?
Because, I don't know, Chris called it that, I think?
What? No, I remember specifically why we called it Hardee's, because we said that it just sounded dirty and greasy and gross. And then we were just like Hardee's. And we're like, yeah, exactly, like Hardee's. And I remember this song, we can talk about it more after, but in particular this one, Daniel, you had a guitar on, and you were like, I've had this riff forever. Yep. I've tried to put it in like 15 songs and it's never worked, and it's like this, and you're like sitting down on the floor playing this riff, and we're just like, that riff is awesome. We
Indian style, mind you.
Yes, I don't know why I have that. Yeah, so Grant, take us there. Let's listen to that one.
Oh,
That song is just riff after riff. Punishment.
I really like that song, but from not long after this album being out, I wished that we had done more with the end. Like, this is one of the only songs where when I listen to it, I'm like, man, this is good, but we could have done, I think, something more interesting at the end. Like, going into that riff again is cool, but I think there could have been something else there. I love this song, but that's
for sure.
This is one of the only songs that we have where I'm like, I wish we could go back and
that biker riff occupies like 22% of the runtime.
I mean, that's what happened with the song.
Octave pedal and non-octave pedal.
We had that riff and we were just playing that forever and like, how are we going to end this song? And we're just like,
go back to it.
Let's put an octave pedal on it and keep going.
And then just stop somehow.
It faded out. Like, we played it for maybe another minute and we were like, oh, just fade it. And then when we got the mix back, we were like, that's really cheesy. We can't like fade it out. And so we told I forget who mixed it, but we were like,
I think you did an awesome job.
Yeah. And we were like, just do some sort of little feedback thing and just like cut it. I didn't make that.
As far as I remember,
static thing wasn't anything we did in the studio, unless it was like a sample that he picked from. But I think we were just wanted to cut, and put some static stuff.
Movie magic,
right? I mean, that's pretty sure that's what happened.
And all the riffs before that, like the bow, wham, bow, bow, wham, like that was all part of that little bag of riffs that you were like, I have all these riffs and I don't know what to do with them. We're like, let's put them all together in a row and just
Jacob don't care in the chat said, I originally thought the lyric was bow to my existence. And I was like, all right, weird flex, but okay.
Bow to my existence.
I think I love the vocals in that song.
I remember thinking that's what someone might think, and then I was like, nah, it'll be fine, because I didn't want someone to think that. I remember that specifically. It's funny that guy said that.
Oh, Speed, own it. You're awesome.
I think like during that whole biker part, I think that was the biker riff, like where it's just a hi-hat part that we ride out for a long time.
Yeah.
The beggars and chooser vocals, I think, are so cool. I've always loved that part.
Yeah, lyrically as well.
It seems like when we were doing the biker riff, it seemed to recall it, like the idea was like, let's just do this too long. It's like, let's just go on a ride, and if they want to come along, cool. If they drop off, who cares?
And then by the time we got the mix back, we didn't care. So yeah. I think one thing, I know Aaron's been not silent, but this is a unique thing for him, and obviously Daniel, Aaron, you guys are obviously all friends, but I think one thing to note this far in the record is realizing how much like certain people, probably me more than others, really like every song on this album. I'm like, oh, this part and oh, this part. But then zooming out, realizing like the reason why all these parts are able to go so long and potentially be like too over the top is because Aaron creatively in like the sphere of like writing an Underoath brought the tension that left with him was released and there wasn't any like filter. And I think like as much as I love this record and I think it's like I love every single song, I almost feel like I shouldn't love it that much because it's like we're supposed to be a unit. And I personally love it, which means like there's something missing for other people at times. Not trying to get into a weird conversation, but just thinking about, you know, how cool it was to write with Daniel I'd be interested to see if Aaron was there, like what he would have shifted. And like, we've talked about it a bit, obviously, but just some of the things wouldn't have gone too long or been so like on the nose ripoff. Cause it's like, there's always a check and balance and like, Daniel was new and we've been friends and we've all been writing together and we just like had fun and we were just like going. And it's like interesting to see the tensions that we have with Aaron even still as a unit versus just having a we don't know what's happening. Let's just have fun and write the record we want to write without thinking about anything, versus having people coming from really hardline different areas and really pushing back. Not that Daniel didn't. I just think his ideas and our ideas aligned so well that, yeah, we wrote all that so quickly and it was really interesting. But I that song specifically made me go, dude, this is like cringy for Aaron. If I had to put myself in Aaron's shoes, he's like, I would have done everything differently. Like, that's so cool, you guys don't know how to write a song. Like, I just hear Aaron's internal dialogue and I just kind of wanted to give that to you. And like, if you have anything to add,
yeah,
in a respectful way, you know,
this is the only analogy I can think of. And it's so fucked. So just bear with me. I feel like I'm married to the five of you. So we work out how to get to zero, you know? And I feel like, for this record, and I, you know, listening to it now, I haven't listened to it this detailed. I love it too. That last song, I would have lost my mind over. And there's a lot of things I would have lost my mind over. But here's the thing, though. That's what makes it so great, though, is because you guys got out of your marriage for a few years and got to be with this super hot chick who, like,
yeah, or guy. Is.
or what, you know, however you want to put it, and do exactly what you wanted to do. And I think that's the beauty of this thing, you know what I mean, Daniel? Like Tim said, Daniel's ideas aligned so much more with yours at the time. And I feel like, you know, where we are now as a band, our ideas align more than they did then. But I think what has made Underoath through the years has been that tension, you know. And so to hear a record like this record was so needed. I think that we probably wouldn't be having an Underoath conversation today without this record. I feel like this was sort of this made it last, you know, because this needed to be done. You know, we all needed the break, you know, in terms of the way that we create. So I think that you have this as this reprieve for the five of you. And I think for the listener too, it's a reprieve. You know, Underoath is a taxing thing sometimes, I think, you know, because it's a lot. So, yeah,
I know it's a lot for me. Good Lord.
Good Lord. This album is so sick, dude. I'm so taxed, man. This is so dope.
I could play that last riff forever. Just let it keep repeating. Just keep it going.
We should have kept it going. Just fade that bitch out, dude.
The fade out thing Daniel was talking about literally makes me want to go jump in the river. I can't imagine that.
I remember even in the studio when we were talking about just fading that riff out, we were like, we can't just do like a 1985 volume fade at the end. And where we're like, and we're just like, hell yeah, let's just do it. Why the heck not? And
then yeah, it was like, exactly.
And then it was just, at least we had some sense, some of our senses about us. That's good.
It's like a bunch of kids without a parent around, just like, yeah, do it. I dare you. Okay. And then you're just at a spot where you're like,
you know what would have been cool? And not that it matters, but do you guys, I don't know, Daniel, have you ever heard that? The Nine Inch Nails Add Violence EP. Anyways, there's a song, like the last track on that record, and it goes for it fades sort of for like 5 minutes, but they just keep adding distortion and keep adding distortion
until that part's sick.
Until you can't tell what's happening. That would have been sick.
Back pocket. We'll rip that off like for another record.
Studio added feedback. That we were just like, yeah, leave it. That's cool. Because when we got that, we were already all like out of the studio, out of that kind of like mindset. Because we did the mixing, like we got it online or something, and we could, isn't that right?
Nice,
we could, like,
cast.
Yeah,
we had to like tune in.
Yeah, and we're like, yeah, just add some feedback there, and it'll be fine. I don't even know if we heard it, but anyway, yeah.
Put a bow on it. All right, last track.
Oh shoot!
Do it.
Rip it.
Don't skip to the next record, Grant.
God damn it!
Motherfucker's already playing Chase and Safety.
We'll be right back.
I love that end, man. That end is so cool.
Yeah.
One of my favorite songs on the record. I love that song.
Matt, you get the best drum sounds. Let's talk about that. Jeez.
Matt, you're muted. We can't hear you.
Oh, click the big red thing.
Yeah, I know. I know. So somebody asked if there were samples. Since I didn't mix it, I can't say. But I will say, unlike some other records, these drums on this record sound like the drums we tracked.
They do, yeah.
And yeah, the drums sounded, I mean, yeah, the drums on the mix sound like the drums we recorded. So there could have been some samples in there, but it sounds like what we recorded. And I do, they did turn out real, real good.
They sound good. Huge. Yeah, that sounds amazing.
Particularly the beginning of that song when it's just
That's what made me say that. I remember, this goes way back to stuff we'll get to later in this series, but I always wanted to record drums with Matt, and that it's cool hearing like your own band with someone else playing. Yeah, it's, dude, that sounds so good. I don't know that I've heard that song more than one time. That's unreal. Super dope.
I love that track.
So good. Fuck. I texted Spencer on the side. I was like, this is wild.
Yeah, I always love the lyrics.
Yeah, that's lyrically. That's one that like pops in my head probably once a week, which is weird. But yeah, that one, I love that song.
Yeah, Lord Doofus in the track says, can we get everyone's favorite song on the album before the end of this thing?
Oh,
it's tough, man.
Driftwood for me, and then if I have to pick one, that I love Masurge too.
Yeah,
I think I would know the names still.
I wonder though. Okay, I know, Tim, your musical taste to some degree, and I know like what Driftwood does is probably a little bit more like what you listen to, than what y'all play. So
that's for sure.
The how much do you separate your favorite song, like the ones you like jam to the most, and the ones you like to play the most, and the ones you like, I totally get being really proud of Driftwood because that's doing something a little bit outside of what you normally do as a band, but also is closer to what you know. I know both you and Speed. I know Speed's a huge Radiohead fan, so it makes sense.
I think we were talking about that last week, honestly. Like, how do you separate what your favorite song is without being so subjective to, like, when we play it live, I feel like this, so this song ranks up.
Sure.
Even if it's an inferiorly written song, quote unquote, but it makes you feel this thing, like you rank it higher than it should be, quote unquote. And it's like, I think that's the beauty of music, is that I don't think there's a right answer. It's just like, whichever one's your favorite, like the weird Deviate My Life, you know, Beastie Boys song could be somebody's favorite for a very good reason. And you're like, there's no way that's your favorite song. It's like, no, it literally is, you know?
The point is, it doesn't sound like listening through any given song when it's playing, if somebody asks, is this your favorite on the record? I'd probably say, yeah, probably. But then in the middle of the next song, somebody asks you, is this your favorite? I'd be like, yeah, this is my favorite.
I think record to me is like the most consistent body of work, in the sense that it's, if you like the first song, you will like everything between now and the last song.
Right.
And, you know, I think if you wanted to like shit on that idea, you could say, oh, it's linear and one dimensional. If you want to praise it, you could say, wow, like everything interweaves from tunings to like when it goes down and up. And that's for everyone to decide. I think it's subtly diverse. It's not overtly diverse like most Underoath albums are. And I love the subtleties going, whoa, we pulled back there, and whoa, we went way too heavy there, but then we pulled back on the next song. Like, as a complete body of work, I would argue every song has a place in being a rotating cast of the top three for sure.
Yeah, what's funny is before we did this, I would have said that probably Illuminator was my favorite.
Oh, yeah.
But when we listened, I hadn't listened to Who Will Guard the Guardians in I don't know how long, and that song just gave me chills to listen back to, and I think that that might be my favorite, might be my favorite one.
Yeah, for me too, because there's so many memories with that, creating that in the studio and then doing the video with that, with the circle dealy thing.
Mm-hmm.
That was just such a special moment, and something that I still think about when I think about this record.
I always think about playing it too. That's probably why.
Yeah, that's a weird thing that, as like performing the song, definitely affects how you feel about the song. You know, it's like, whereas like somebody just listening to the record that's not performing it has their favorite song for whatever reason, but it's going to be different from the person
mm-hmm.
playing the song live. They're going to have, there's so many, like James, like what you just said, there's so many memories, both writing the song, the memories of in the studio and kind of what's happening in life at that point, and then playing the song. So there, it's like there's all these different things coming into play there, which is mm-hmm. really interesting. And I don't think any of that should be removed as far as why one has a favorite song, you know?
Even to Matt's point and question, I think, you know, like Daniel said, as a listener, your favorite songs, Driftwood or Who Will Guard the Guardians or Illuminator, and there's probably a lot of ties, just like remembering when you wrote it, remembering when you recorded it, remembering the one show and the kids stage dove during it or whatever that is for us. Like, this is my favorite song because that's the day my dad died, or that's the day my girlfriend broke up with me, or that's the day my son was born. It's like, I think everyone, whether you made it or you're a listener of it, like, you can't just have it a completely objective, this is the best song on the record because music says so. Like, I think everyone is tainted and coded and phased by their emotional and social interactions with the song in a moment in time, thus making it a higher rank. And I think it's the same for us, and we'll never be able to like remove ourselves from all that and just look at it like objectively. It's always going to be subjective, you know?
I personally, like, this is one of the few albums where I can't like pick a favorite song. Like, I literally have like five songs where I'm like, I really love this song for, like you said, like for this reason. Like, Paper Long, I love as like this, like as a song. And then I love like Divine Eradication, like riff wise, and then, like, you know what I mean? Like, there's so many different elements in this album to me that stand out enough to where it's not just like, oh, this is the song, this is the one, oh, this is the one. It's like every one I can pick on something. In the same aspect, there's probably some part on some song where I'm like, oh, this could be cooler here, or this could change here, but there, every song has a spot or a couple parts or like a moment that I'm just like, oh damn, this is so good. And then I go to the next song, I'm like, oh, this one. And then, you know what I mean? So for me, this album, like, I can't pick a favorite song. I think this album is just its own like thing.
I'm really curious to see how that plays in going back. Like, I think the same thing is going to happen with Lost in the Sound next week. Like, just going like, oh, this is the song. And then right. It's like, oh, shoot, that's the song, you know? Like, it's just so weird to come back, because, I mean, I think it goes without saying, but we don't really listen to our music, like, as a band, I would argue. So, like, everyone who's watching and commenting and whatever, like, we're, like, reliving this moment. Like, I haven't listened to that record front to back since we probably proofed the mix and I showed it to my friends. I've listened to songs in between, but, like, there were parts that I forgot we wrote until hearing them tonight. So it's interesting to go back and retrospectively, it's like, I think the album's great. I'm so glad we got to spend those years with Daniel and in the studio and with Matt and Jeremy. And like, it was a unique time for us. It was a once in a lifetime thing. And we'll never, you know, go back to that, in the sense that like Aaron was gone and Aaron's back. And like, in that moment, I wouldn't have wanted to have anyone else but Daniel there. And like, that was super sick. That's like a really cool portion of my life, for sure.
Sure.
Hell yeah, it was.
So we've gone through all of the album. Matt, Daniel, thank you guys for hanging.
Certainly.
If you guys need to go, anyone that needs to go can go. We're a little earlier than we were last week, and I'm definitely getting, just seeing the chat is super blowing up over Sunburn Unsound. So if anyone wants to stay and go over those two last songs, you're more than welcome. You need to go. Totally cool. But I guess that kind of those two songs, although they're not on the album, they're kind of in that era. So I'm going to roll those two. I'm going to stick around, hang out, and play those through. If anybody wants to stay and hang, totally cool. I don't want to keep you guys. And if you got stuff going on, just let me know what you feel, what you're feeling.
Yeah, I'll stick around.
I'll stay and listen. I haven't heard those in a long time.
I'm going to bounce. Appreciate you guys. Good to see you. Good to see your faces, Matt, Daniel.
Good to see you.
Goodbye, Jim.
See you.
Peace out. Bye, Jimmy.
Great. Now that he's out of here, let's party. Yeah.
Fuck right. That
Daniel,
guy.
Daniel, what's your least favorite part about James? Go.
It's like, it's kind of like this record. I can't like pick. I can't.
Why you don't? This is why you don't leave first.
You'll be the first guy out. All right.
You'll be the first guy to go to sleep on the bus.
I love these two songs, man.
My AirPods are dying, so I don't know what's going to happen when this one dies. But I'm going to stick around as long as I can.
Okay.
Hurry up, Grant. Push play. Goddammit.
Okay. Cool. All right, here we go. We'll be right back.
Fuck yeah.
Dude, so I saw kids asking if these were recorded at the same time as Disambiguation, and they weren't. No. We went back to Goldman's and recorded these well after all the touring for Disambiguation. This was kind of like, I remember this being like, well, the band's done, so do whatever you want. That was the vibe going into these songs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think these songs are some of my favorite, at least during that, like, 5-6 year span of Underoath. These two were, and I think it's a clear bridge to the like future of what we did after, which was Erase Me. I think this kind of like leads you into that pretty well, but I don't think a lot of people got to hear these songs because they only came out on
Anthology.
Yeah. Those two songs, these two, well, there's another one, but yeah, I love these songs.
Yeah. And Matt, you mix those.
Yeah, I mix these guys.
Like we had the songs you mixed from Chasing Safety come out on some deluxe or bonus edition streaming thing. And I think that goes back to like the, why is that your favorite song? And are you right? Like, I understand how like right. Ben Gross. No, but I know, but you were dialoguing, you weren't pushing back at me, but I feel like a Ben Gross or a Chris Lord Alge are like, technically better mixers than you, and you wouldn't argue with that, but no. When I hear you mix our stuff, I feel like those songs have the most soul. Like, it's maybe not like frequency correct all the time, but it's correct enough to where like those drums, like people are like, are there samples or they're not, like those are your drums on those songs, right. This song and the next one, it's like those drums sound great as they are. And then everyone else just comes in and plugs their stuff in. But like, I feel like the energy and the vibe and like the intensity on those tracks are as good, if not better, than some of the mixed tracks from
the last album. I prefer to hear, you know, on the drum tip, I prefer to hear that than a super compressed replaced Chris Lord Alge drum, which we can talk about in a couple weeks. But like, yeah, I would prefer to hear that. Like, yeah, I don't know. I think that you've just become such a big part of the Underoath sound. Like, yeah, super interesting to know that. I didn't know you mixed that until just now.
Gotcha.
I would prefer to hear that.
Yeah, I don't know exactly how that came out, because I know it was the anthology is coming out, Tooth and Elbow. We have to put a couple more songs on it, just because what you have to do when you put out a greatest hits or whatever. And and so it was like the contractual obligation songs, and but they did turn out really, really cool. Well, I'm glad I got to mix them, because I don't know. I don't think we went into it with the. I don't think the plan was for me to mix them. I don't know if anybody.
I don't even remember. I don't remember a plan.
I don't think honestly. We had a plan. I don't even remember if we were contractually obligated, to be honest. Like, I just remember.
I think we were. I remember.
We might have been.
I remember specifically.
Did we write those on? Sorry, go ahead.
I was just gonna say, I remember what you were saying earlier, Daniel, like being in the, or Spencer, being in the studio and just being like, damn, these songs are awesome. Sucks we're breaking up, because we already knew it was over. We were just writing these, or recording these two songs we had, and it was for the anthology. And it was just like, I remember thinking like, and you, I think you can really, like Spencer said, you can see elements of these two songs, especially the next one in Erase Me. But I think that it's interesting, because I remember talking at the time or somebody, and I was just like, yeah, this is like the kind of from Disambiguation to these songs was like, I could see this, like the path in a sense of where the band was going to like kind of go with the current members of that time. And I was like, you know, it was really exciting because I liked these two songs a lot. I feel like we were kind of getting like you said, like Tim said, Disambiguation was this kind of like, let's all just try this, go here. There's no real rules or limits. And I think that not a bad thing, but I think these two songs we had toured for, you know, a couple years together, and we kind of get into the spot where we all like had a mutual thought on songs, and you know, in a sense. And it was like bittersweet for sure.
Yep.
I remember writing in the Falkenberg space. Like they
you
were
do
they
or don't
so fun. I do.
Okay, yeah, I was gonna ask if we wrote them on tour, or I couldn't.
I remember that really riff. Remember. I remember that writing that verse riff Tim had maybe 5 years ago, and he showed to me. We were actually sound checking a Masquerade. I specifically remember that, and he had forgotten about it, and I just always noodled around with it, and we were looking for his songs, and I was like, yo, what about this riff that you had like 5 years ago, and I played it, and we were like, oh shit, that's pretty cool, let's try and work something with that. And that's where that kind of came from.
Yeah, I also want to say there's been quite a few comments in the chat wanting to know about Daniel's short film that he did for that was for Unsound.
It was for that for song.
Yeah, for Sunbird. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. I think people just want to know where they can see it. Is it anywhere?
It's on my Vimeo. Yeah,
I think you can find it online. I've seen it.
It might be on YouTube. I don't know that I ever put it there, but it's on Vimeo, and that would be linked from my personal website.
Yeah, that thing's really good. What's your site?
Yeah, can you post that in the chat, Grant or Daniel?
It's
or whoever.
DanielDavison.net. Yeah, it should be on there. Yeah, that was fun. I think we had a little budget to do a video, and then me, Tim, and one of my buddies, this dude Oscar, like came up with this kind of wild idea to, instead of just a video, make a short film out of it. Release and then cut a music video out of that short film. But it was like a 25-minute short film, and we also used all that content, I think during the last tour, as
you sold
projection
it.
Content.
And you sold it as like a flash drive, right?
Yeah, there was a shirt printed from like stills from two shirts from stills from the short film. And then it came with a little USB drive with the film on it. So it was kind of a multifaceted experience. You see the footage at the show, and then it's also the music video, and then it's this film.
Yeah,
and it's cool. Awesome.
Thanks. Sick. Yeah, it was fun.
All right.
All right, Grant, last one.
The one, last one, actually. Let's see. Unsound.
Whatever makes you all again, whatever brings you all.
Dude, hell yeah. Can I also, can I say that I love, Spencer, I don't know if you remember, but there was a version of the end of that song where at the last like heavy part, you screamed. And then we were like, this song doesn't need screaming at all. And we just cut the scream and there was just no vocals there. I love that we did that. And also, I haven't listened to that song legitimately since we played it live. I haven't heard it. And it totally brought me back to whatever tour it was that we played it. I think it was the farewell tour. Yeah, we would, whenever there was those drum fills before the choruses, Andy would do this thing on Daniel where it was just lights on Daniel. And every night I would look over and just and see the lights on Daniel. I was like, oh, that's so badass. But yeah, that's a good song.
I love that tune.
Yeah.
I remember the deliberate, I don't remember if it was Tim or Chris who wanted it, but I remember like on that chorus, there's no, as far as I remember, there's not any rhythm guitar. Mm-hmm. It's just the picking all this, just a huge synth.
That was Tim's idea. I remember that.
I remember that too.
It was tricky to get to, again, to kind of just like we're talking about on the other song where it's all just, you know, just the bass carrying the riff is so trying to find the right synth sound. We felt like it was okay not to have guitar.
Yeah.
Taking a couple of minutes.
Which is super interesting going forward. Like with, you know, a couple of you guys were mentioning about how this was kind of alluding to Erase Me and Spencer singing a lot here. And that's something we do a lot now is there won't be a rhythm guitar. That's something we do so much. And the funny part about that is a lot of times Tim is the proponent of that being the guitar player. Like, we don't need, fuck a guitar. We don't need it.
Yeah, this sounds cool, but let's get rid of my instrument first. And then.
But that's something we do a lot now. And I never knew that about this song until you guys just said it. That's kind of our MO a lot lately, you know? Interesting.
Yeah, we also tried that. I meant to mention it when we listened to it. It's like four or five songs back on the actual record, but there's a bridge, I think it might even be the last song, where we tried that and it's still on the record. But I remember having this idea of it being bigger, but it feels more like an old Appleseed Cast song, like it's very timid and melodic, and then it goes into the chorus, and then we brought that idea back and kind of nailed it more. But even on that song, because it's more of a, not a ballad, but more dynamic, like Matt, your drums on that song, like Daniel's drums, obviously, but your mix of Daniel's drums, like the drums sound great on that.
Well, thanks,
just
man.
Your slaps, dude.
Yeah. And a lot of people in the chat too are asking if Spencer wants to go into just the idea behind the lyrics of this one as well. Quite a few people are asking.
I mean, those both of those songs, Sunburn and Unsound, you can kind of hear that it's like, I'm kind of looking at, I mean, I guess we were in a decade at that point of me being in the band when we were tracking those songs and breaking up. It was just kind of like a reflection on like, you know, like whatever makes you whole again, like for the other guys, because I didn't want the band to break up, you know, like, I'm the only one still standing like that. I wanted to keep going. Obviously, I was like pretty hurt that we were breaking up, but everyone had different paths in their life at that time, and we were going different ways. And you know, it's just kind of like a, like looking back on things, and like, you know, I talk about how I'm like dirtier now because, you know, just my life and getting into drugs and, you know, touring and not really, you know, enjoying it to the fullest while I was there, and like looking back on it and just being pretty sad about it. I think in those songs, and being like, okay, letting my friends and this thing that I love so much go, and being okay with everyone, you know, whatever makes them happy and whatever makes them feel whole again. And that kind of whole thing of just like, it's a song about me and like looking at myself, but also my bandmates, and just being like, it's dissolving, you know, like both of those songs, you know, Summer and Unsound were pretty much about the end of the band, you know. It's pretty brutal to hear about now.
I remember it was the time in the studio, like, felt really heavy. And I think that it's Matt was able to kind of capture that feeling, at least. Yeah. And maybe it's me and nostalgia, but it's to me, it's very apparent and very like tangible, those, and it, lyrically too, all that makes, these songs have a lot of feeling, a lot of heavy emotions.
Yeah.
I remember that time just feeling split. Like it was like me and James and Chris, all varying degrees, from more on like, we can't do 9 or 10 months a year. We have kids now. And then Grant and Spencer are single and just sold out for this idea. And then you, Daniel, being, you know, 2 or 3 years in, going, me and Tess are malleable, but I'm totally down to keep going. And I get both sides, but like, we should still do it if we can, is like my nostalgic recollection of it. Yeah. And it just feeling like,
that's pretty accurate.
Grant was frustrated. Mm-hmm. Spee was like, I'm going to be lost. Like, this is all I have. And we're like, but we have these kids, and, you know, putting the band in a distant second to, you know, even Spee and Grant felt like we were putting the band in last place. And it really was, because up until then, like, the band was not just first. It was like, we tell girlfriends we're not coming home. We tell parents we're missing anniversaries and whatever. Like, it's the band. And all of a sudden, for the first time, we blinked, and there was 3 or 4 reasons, being our small human beings, that's like, this band doesn't matter that much anymore. And it's not that it matters less. It's, there's something new that matters even more, and this band still matters this much. And that was really hard for all of us to not only communicate and talk about. So then it came off worse, but yeah, it was just a weird time. Like, I remember breaking up, being like ready to be done, but then like bawling at Janice at the last show.
Then
immediately driving home going, thank God that's over. But I was like, why was I crying? Why did it mean so much? I thought I was done. Like, all that just processing was such a weird,
I think,
2 months.
Yeah. And I think for like that whole, like, the band was our life until you guys started having kids. And I think even until Erase Me and we get back together, and I'm like, you know, in a different spot and like gotten off drugs and stuff, it wasn't until then where I figured out that Underoath is a huge part of my life, but it's not my only life. And I think it was, and I think that's why I was,
it was
so
all upset. Of our lives. Yeah. Like, it was
I didn't have a wife. I didn't have any kids. Like I was almost like, I was trained to put that at the forefront of my brain, and it never left. And maybe I just grew up later, but I figured it out later after we had to break up and get back together, that like, it's a huge part of my life, but it isn't my life. My only, you know, that's not my only identity. And I think it was until I learned how to cope with the, you know, being angry and being sad with the breakup and everything in between. And then the rebirth happened, and then figuring it all out. But that was, I think all that stuff kind of had to happen, at least for me, to get to where I'm at, you know, like, and that was huge. It was hard. I mean, those songs are heavy, hard to hear, but
yeah.
I would say same for me. I think like, in a weird way, like almost like this mentality of like, how are you going to survive without the band kind of thing? Because it was, you know, literally like for me, like got out of high school, never went to college, never had a career job. I just got in a van with dudes and, you know, that many years later. And then, you know, we had circumstances where like, you know, change of members and stuff where we almost broke up before. And there was always this, like, this looming fear of like, what are you going to do? Like, what's going to happen? And it was still there, obviously, and apparent. And like, for me, it was, as much as the breakup sucked, it was also really like good thing to be like, yo, like Spencer said, like the band is huge in your life, but it's not you and it's not your life. Like, you're not defined by this thing. And to kind of make it through that and come out like on top and in a good spot, I think was a huge thing. And it was such a interesting way to look at it, looking back at like remembering the last show, remembering being in the airport with Tim and James and Spee and talking about like the end and quitting and breaking up and stuff. And like my emotions there to my emotions now and my viewpoints on things. It's like me and Spencer couldn't relate to where Tim and Chris and James were, because we didn't have kids, you know, and we tried to, but you really can't unless you're in that scenario. And so it's such an interesting thing now, you know, like being in a different spot and growing and stuff and seeing that now and being like, oh, all right, I get where you're at, respect it a lot more now. It was still super hard, but it's I think it's a cool thing to like be able to look back and like, and on top of that, still be able to do it. We're still in the band doing it.
Yeah, I think that's an awesome thing, just to kind of see how all of that brings us back to where we are now. Because like Spencer was saying, like the band is such a huge part of all of our lives, and I think it will always be, you know, however long we continue to do it. But the idea that it doesn't define us as people anymore, I think, is a super liberating thing. Yeah, because I remember that the first morning after that last show at Janice, after we broke up, I woke up and I was like, oh, this is the first time that I'm not Chris Dudley from Under Oath. I'm just I've never not been in a band since I've been like in high school. Like I'm just, who am I? And like kind of yeah, like you said, like having that whole
hard, yeah.
Yeah, it was an interesting journey, but I think going through all that and making that break from that identity and then coming back and realizing like, oh, like my life is like all of this here, and
all
the
of
band
these things, yeah.
is like a huge part of it, but it's not all of it. And I think that makes me enjoy it. And I think I can speak for all of us in that, like, you know, cause toward the end of, you know, when Daniel was in the band, I think there was just, you know, obviously there was a lot of tension and people weren't happy and there was, you know, fighting and stuff. And to be able to kind of come full circle and to have everybody doing what they're doing and being happy and just, yeah, I don't know. It's awesome.
It is.
And Daniel's just living in a freaking on a ranch in a trailer.
He's a ranch hand. He's a happy jolly rancher.
Jolly rancher.
Indeed. Jolly rancher.
Y'all come out. Come hang out.
Oh, dude, that would be so sick. Where are you? What state?
Arizona.
Oh,
I've been in Tucson for the last like 2 years, but just literally like a week ago moved an hour southeast of Tucson to area called Sonoita. It's just ranch land.
That's so awesome. Gosh. That's
yeah.
So cool. Well, freaking A. Well,
sweet. Well, yeah.
That might be it, dude, then, right?
Daniel, Matt, thank you guys for your time. It's always good to catch up.
Definitely.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Yeah. And both of you guys, absolutely. What are you guys, what are you guys working on right now? If folks are watching this and they want to, if you're working on something you want people to see or hear, where would they be able to do that?
I've been writing a lot of music recently, but none of it is, I haven't posted anything, but probably will at some point. But yeah, I don't have anything current posted, but yeah, my website that I mentioned earlier, I update maybe like once or twice a year. So that might be a spot. And yeah, I guess that's really it. But yeah.
If it weren't for the shutdown mess, I would be doing the new All Get Out record right now.
Oh,
no way. I didn't know they just did a tour.
So good.
Yeah. Oh. So it's going to happen eventually. But I don't know.
So Matt Goldman, where can people that are watching hire you to do their record? Are you do you take cold calls? Do you take swipe rights?
You can send me a Facebook message or emails thematgoldman@gmail.com.
Is your email still the same?
Yeah.
thematgoldman@gmail.
Yeah. No, I
probably still have this.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was emailing with Grant today about this stuff, and his email's the same.
Yours popped up for mine too. Both of yours did, actually. I was like, this is weird.
No, I do have, this is, I haven't officially announced it, but, and this is so right now I've got all my gear up in a studio in Tennessee, north of Knoxville. And that's still like, that's kind of my home base right now, even though I live in Atlanta. And I'm a little reluctant to announce this because it's not, I don't
want
to
spill it.
I'm actually going to rent. Announce. I'm actually going to be moving into my old place in Little Five Points. I'm going to keep the place in Tennessee.
The old spot.
Yeah. That's gonna
the place behind the pizza place.
Yeah.
Let's
so
go,
that place. I'll have that place for like, if there's like local, like there's some Atlanta bands that want to like want to work and they don't want to drive 4 hours away. So I'm gonna have a place to work in Atlanta, a place to do overdubs and that sort of stuff. I'll probably still go up to Tennessee for like full length, you know, records. We're gonna spend a few weeks.
What about bands that live in Florida that want to drive 4 hours?
Or more. Well, something is miracle. The little Five Boys studio is really small.
A shit, man? That's the place.
But we'll see.
You remember we all sleep in there, dude?
Yeah, on the floor.
On the demos for only chasing safety, I think.
Yeah, on the ground.
I remember we did Logic there last time. Is it big enough to fit Pro Tools in there? Like, can you fit a whole Pro Tools rig in there or no?
We did all the drums for Define in there.
Right, exactly.
I mean, and,
Matt, are you going to come back and do this again when we do?
Yeah, sure.
Dude, hell yeah.
I mean, we all have plenty of time right now.
You're going to be here for the next 5 Wednesdays for 4 hours a night. Just going, yeah, I remember that one too. They're all idiots. Yep.
I'll remember less about the next two, probably.
Dude, I can't believe you got that place back.
This might be a sore subject, but didn't like an intern or somebody from, I remember this being a thing.
Oh yeah.
From yeah, Little Five, like leaked.
Oh, we're gonna get into that.
First Matt leaks our stems to the 68, then he leaks our record to the public.
Yeah.
You know that is false.
I know it is.
You can talk about that next, tune in next time.
Tune in next week.
You gotta wait 2 episodes for
that. Is Daniel producing the show with a big old cliffhanger?
We might need to have a talk about L5P pretty soon.
Okay.
Get that up on the next record for sure.
Much beat.
All right. Well, yeah. Thank you guys so much.
Grant, how do we sign off of Twitch?
Just like that, Tim. You have to hold your Twitchers? Fingers like that.
Just leave
your
Twitchers.
Yeah. There you go.
Twitchers. I love you. Goodbye. Awesome.
No, thank you guys so much.
You guys,
love you all.
COVID hugs. Bye. Love you.
COVID hugs. Goodbye.
Bye.
COVID.
Thanks for watching.
Are we still here?
Yeah,
but I think we're leaving. Goodbye.
Yeah, you click leave.
I love you.